Sup, my fellas, don't forget to leave feedback, and enjoy the story. Our story begins in a coffee shop. A middle-aged hero entered the room carrying the renowned wolf's head, and a significant piece of news was airing on television at that precise moment. This waiter greeted the hero as soon as he took a seat. The waiter asked about his hunt for the day and referred to him as Old Qiu. Old Qiu mentioned that it wasn't very significant. He went hunting today with novices, and nothing of value was found among their spoils. Then his gaze shifted to this enormous screen. A momentous occasion was about to begin. This was their Congress broadcast. These congressmen have all cast their votes and are about to reject a proposal. The man declared that there were 325 votes in favor, 0 votes against, and 0 abstentions. He declared that the new regulation, known as the deprivation of the mask, was now in effect. The parliament's president was this man, who went by the name of Yao. He spoke to this mask-wearing hero. He informed him that a great deal of evidence had been gathered to show that this hero had killed civilians in his crimes. Additionally, he charged that the hero's attacks on allied heroes in the other nation led to a disastrous alliance between the two countries. This hero going by the name of Mask has officially been given the death penalty by He Yao and every member of Congress. However, the punishment was lowered due to Mask's assistance in driving the monsters and extraterrestrial invaders off Earth, though there will still be repercussions. All titles pertaining to Mask as the Commonwealth's Supreme Leader and Supreme Marshal will now be withdrawn. As of right now, the Mask's only title is Special Hero. This means that in the event of a problem, Mask will still be required to assist the populace and the government. He still intends to go back to battle if necessary. There was widespread broadcasting of this event. There were those who disagreed with this choice. They were aware that this hero had saved them in numerous crises over the years. This man went on to say that humanity would have perished if masks hadn't been invented. These two youthful heroes, however, pleaded to differ. After telling the man that masks shouldn't get all the credit, they got into a fight. This man went on to support his claims. Because of the way Mask treated the other heroes, he felt this way about him. Mask even entertained the notion that other heroes had abused their position of authority for private gain. Regarding this man, he was aware that none of the accusations were accurate. Now they were once again focused on the broadcast. He revealed to Mask that, as a special hero, he can now exit the platform. He assured him that his contributions as their savior will live on in human memory. Mask remained silent throughout. Hyo caught his attention, and then the congressman. However, there was a problem. Mask was unaware of the situation. He believed that his battle with the Weaving Knight's Lord had already claimed his life. However, he is currently alive and present on this platform. He perceived this as somewhat of a flashback. This was the moment when his friends would betray him. This notification appeared in front of him as he was still trying to gather his thoughts. It came from a framework. It demonstrates that Mask had already succeeded in his mission to assist humanity in creating a new national alliance. Regarding his primary objective, he will have two options. Hero's Path was the name of the first branch. A new crisis has emerged, and he will continue to shield humanity in the shadows even if they were. Monster's Path was the name of the second branch. There is a new crisis, but this time he is going to defend the world like a monster. How he goes about doing this is irrelevant. Ultimately, he will turn into a monster. The system allotted Mask 20 minutes, after which he will be placed in an environment classified as F level. At that moment, the greatest human hero faced a crossroads. But when you give it some thought, it wasn't all that hard. He opted for the monster route this time. At that point, he broke off Mask. Why wasn't the hero answering? He questioned him. He reasoned that perhaps Mask was not happy with their decision. This man was aware of the benefits Masks provided to their society. But he had to make this choice because he was a leader. Many of their political decisions were seriously hampered by Mask's actions. The Congress has been influencing people's perceptions of Masks in an effort to win back the trust of other countries. They used him as their scapegoat over the years, and this move will restore their Congress's reputation because all of the animosity was turned into a mask. As a result, Mask will simply become a historical monument, and everyone will once more rely on Congress. This action also gives these avaricious congressmen carte blanche to act however they please, and those who disagree will receive support. But before these men could even begin to rejoice, Mask interrupted to express his disapproval. Within the space, this raised a commotion. He Yao, though, had anticipated this all along. This was due to the fact that Mask's actions will appear to be an attempt to preserve his status as a public figure, much like the man who had been feeding him lies since the hearing. But then the Mask's plea was heard. He declared that he also wished to renounce his superhero status. All were shocked by this. He was taken aback as well. Mask then folded up and spoke again. He'll forfeit his status as a unique hero. He declared to all that he was sick of playing the hero. He Yao began to yell at the Mask. Now that he's hinting that Mask didn't agree with their decision, he's taking revenge. However, Mask informed him that he wasn't overly disappointed by their decision. Rather, he was happy about it. This guy was not prepared for any of this. He believed that everything would work out so perfectly that they could still use this hero to keep them safe. He believed that the Mask was simply using his strength and power to oppose the Congress. Hyo informed Mask that he is not allowed to go just yet. He went on to say that Mask ought to give up his power as well because he had given up his special hero title. This statement was beginning to cause confusion among the populace. A few of them even believed that asking for this would be excessive. Mask was a hero with rank 13. The next hero down was Hiyao, who was only ranked 9. The only person to successfully pass the 10th level realm was Mask. For the majority of today's heroes, this was an accomplishment that no one could match. This speech went on to say things that would damage the public's perception of the Mask. He said that after giving him all the resources, Mask had no right to just up and leave them. And Mask must now relinquish his power if he truly wishes to renounce his role as a hero. Mask answered, and his aura began to bubble over. He froze into silence. Both the congressmen and the onlookers experienced this in the same way. Mask concurred with the state of the Yao. Then he lifted a hand, beginning to concentrate his strength. Now he will surrender his power. Inside the arena, these avaricious men began to sense pressure. Mask, meantime, kept accumulating power. Additionally, people began to pass out. The pressure is just too much for them to bear. Even Hiyao began to falter. Even though he is a rank 9 hero, he had to use all of his strength to remain conscious in front of the Mask. The aura of this hero was enough to bring everyone to their knees in front of him. And he was more than happy to return his power to them now that they desired it. A massive beam of light shot up into the sky. Everything that this hit was Some who witnessed this from outside even believed it to be a strange phenomenon. They believed that a monster of the king class had descended upon their city. However, this time, the light beam that had previously represented humanity's best chance meant something else. Once more, these betrayed a hero for their personal benefit. And Mask finished releasing his power after a while. He was taken aback that he could even resist the force exerted by the Mask's power. However, he followed this up with a sheedy grin. At last, he believed, Mask was once more just a regular person. The greatest human hero had once again faded into nothing. And the Mask began to move away. He grabbed his mask and pulled it off. At last, he had no more responsibility for these idiots. Hiyao is still not over it. He was aware that he would meet his demise as soon as Mask left this location. But then, beneath the mask, a brilliant red light emerged. And after that he was moved. Hiyao is in shock over what transpired. Once more, several notifications appeared. Somewhere along the portal, Mask was carried to a level 4 secret realm, a mother spider's nest. When these heroes emerged, they intended to raid this hidden domain. They were going to take on level 3 spider guards, their leader forewarned his group. These spiders were as large as people. This woman told their healer that fear is unnecessary. Then, eager to get rid of the monsters, these guys told their leader to stop playing around. The other person believed that since they wouldn't be able to watch the trial of the mask, it was also a waste. The woman said that since other heroes would also be raiding this location, they would not have had access to this secret realm if it weren't for the mask's trial. And eventually their leader announced that it was time for them to exit this dungeon. However, the portal glowed once more before they could pass through. They believed that someone was emerging from it. This man emerged from the entranceway. The fact that the man entered the hidden world unprepared led these guys to believe that there was a problem. It had been a while since he had entered a lower level dungeon like this one, and this guy was Mask. Then, having just woken up, he recalled something. Mask unintentionally entered a dungeon with a time limit to clear, and the demon god boss there was. However, Mask is once again a regular citizen at this point. Even though he is only a level 1 human, the system brought him here. Mask was still unsure of the direction he was going in, but he was eager to see how things developed, especially since he now had to save the world as a monster. Then the party leader came up to him. If Mask was there to raid the dungeon, he inquired. Where was his weapon? He inquired as well. Our MC informed the leader that his fist would be his weapon because he was without any equipment. The leader assumed that Mask was a martial artist, so he was relieved. This particular class focuses on using one's own body as a weapon. The leader inquired about Mask's proficiency as well. He thought this martial artist would be at least a level 3. He was informed by RMC that he was only level 1. The party as a whole was shocked. The leader came over to him once more. When he questioned him about whether he intended to perish inside the dungeon, the Mask replied that he was there to clear the area. These men did not accept it. A level 1 hero without any equipment, after all, could not hope to defeat a level 3 secret realm. The Mask then instructed them to unwind. He won't even make an effort to annoy them. The leader took care to keep this man's words in mind. He assured RMC that they wouldn't bother themselves, even if he needed their assistance. Following their discussion, the group entered the domain. However, the woman gave RMC one more glance before walking away from him. Then they began fighting inside the realm. This woman attacked these monsters with her fire ability. The other guy was an archer, and when his teammates needed him, he delivered extra damage and support. the other guy and their leader were assigned to the front lines. Our MC, meantime, was merely observing them from the sidelines. Then this girl came up to him. She explained to Mask that their leader was actually just worried about his safety because the realm was a dangerous place to be, not because he was a nasty man. She told him he would die if he did not take care. Mask then began praising these heroes in the present day. He claimed that they had truly evolved into cautious and progressive people. He believed that their tears and blood were used to build all of these things. This girl informed him that although Mask appeared youthful, his speech patterns resembled those of Congress members. In other words, he had an elderly voice. Mask had instituted a policy that led to the development of this characteristic and training among the aspiring professional heroes. To accomplish this, the heroes must work together as a team. And as a result, the death rate inside the realms decreased. This girl then gave her introduction. She was a level 2 healer by the name of Yan Zixi. Mask also gave his introduction. Xiao Qiu was his true name, and he hasn't chosen a class yet. This is the name we will use to refer to him going forward. He stated that he is still debating it. Xiao Qiu believed that he was the creator of every class that exists today. Zixi advised Xiao Qiu to choose spell casting classes because his physical makeup was not really appropriate for melee type classes. Additionally, he won't be in constant danger because of this as he won't be on the front lines. She then expressed her regret to Qiu for being overly chatty. As this continued, this pointed object materialized in front of Zixi. Qiu pulled her in a hurry. It was the monster's attack, and this almost caused Zixi to get heated. This creature is a shadow spider, the archer yelled. After saving this girl from the spider's attack, Qiu swiftly seized one of its legs. It was easy for him to tear it apart with his bare hands. After pulling the leg, Qiu used it to launch a counterattack on the spider. With just his left hand, this guy just defeated a shadow spider. Moreover, he wielded the spider's leg as a weapon. The spider was slain by one blow. The other party guests are in shock over what transpired. They believe that becoming a martial artist was an excessive path. This man claimed to have seen other martial artists before, but none of them were able to match what Qiu did right now. In a split second, RMC precisely located the spider's weakest joint and launched an attack on it. They were aware that the Qiu possessed unusual skill. RMC also instructed Zixi to release since there is no longer a threat. Zixi was unaware that she had been giving Qiu hugs ever since. She quickly expressed regret and became embarrassed upon learning that RMC had discovered that the monster path had no bearing on his leveling system. He gained 500 experience points from the spider, so he won't have to worry about leveling up high-level monsters because experience gains will be proportionate to level, and he could easily regain his former strength when combined with his knowledge from all the battles he fought while still the greatest hero. Qiu's extraordinary talent was also praised by the party's leader. He truly possesses the necessary skills to enter this hidden world. In addition, he thanked Qiu for saving his friend. In addition, when they successfully navigate this realm, Qiu will get a portion of the prize. Our MC informed him that he simply followed the correct course of action. Following that, these experts carried on with their search. They vanquished all of the shadow spiders that were hiding nearby with ease. The boss should now be around the corner, the leader continued. After this battle, they will all return to the real world, he reminded his teammates. The same will apply to their battle strategy. He will take the aggro as a tank, and the others will deal the damage. He also reminded her to use her proficiency with fire to burn the spider silk. The archer was eager to finish because he still wanted to see the mask trial. The other person jumped in and informed him that the mask was probably found guilty. They were interested in the mask's face as well. Nobody had ever seen his face covered by that mask. This girl had previously supported him, but everything changed when the rumor spread that the mask had killed everyone in Tuga City. Zixi then stood up for Mask. She claimed that because everyone inside contracted a demon, the mask had no choice but to act in that way. It was the mask's final option. She was still defending the hero's reputation in front of them, so this guy teased her about it. The leader then instructed them to end the conversation. He reasoned that perhaps Qiu was already fed up with them. And so their search went on once more. They had now reached the area where an increasing number of spider webs were strewn all around them. However, they were more focused on the prize they would receive for taking down the boss monster than they were on being afraid. And something had moved like a monster. This made these experts aware. In front of them, a huge spider really did materialize. While he attracted the boss monster's attention, the leader took the initiative to take the aggro. One of them initiated their assaults. Qiu evaded the attacks with ease. He recalled that there was no intelligence among the monsters in the lower realms. This explains why they are so easily defeated. They kept hitting this monster, overwhelming it with their attacks. While their leader was tanking all the damage, Zixi also offered assistance and healed him, and the monster was vanquished soon after. The team successfully completed a level 3 secret realm without suffering any serious injuries, which made the leader happy. He assured them that the prizes would be given out equally. They'll give Q his fair part as well. Level 3 secret realm, RNC overheard him say. However, he was informed by the system that he would be taken to a level 4 secret realm. He believed that there was a problem in this place. The other guy then yelled that the fallen boss monster was the only treasure chest in the area. They sensed a foreboding aura just in front of the tunnel. Then they noticed this girl approaching them while wearing her school uniform. This woman observed a feature on the girl's head. Her helmet belonged to an astronaut. They now understood that the large spider was not in charge of this realm, which is why the treasure chest had not materialized. This guy then took a position next to the girl. Since the spider was exerting more pressure on him than the girl was, he reasoned that the secret boss was not that powerful. This boss monster had trouble maintaining a straight gait. Her sudden fury sent her racing in their direction. This guy came right up to her. But rather than avoiding his blow, the monster met it head-on and took her out. The attack was well-aimed. The others were simply observing them in silence. This guy even boasted about how simple this fight was. He then withdrew his spear, intending to end this battle. The monster's body had a hole in it from his attack. However, webs emerged from the hole and were aimed at him. He gave his arms to the boss monster. He struggled to break free of the webs, but they were simply too powerful. His arms were broken in an instant when he awoke. Their group went into a panic. The leader gave the woman the order to use her flames because he knew that using physical force against these webs would not succeed. She was able to heat the monster by casting her spell. In case their teammate got caught in the fire, the archer began saving him as well. However, the fire intensified even further before he could approach them, and then they observed several legs emerging from the flames. The female monster has sprouted numerous appendages. She now resembled a spider more. Since they had never seen anything like this before, the team began to panic, and a foot landed on this man's chest as he was screaming. It was an attack by the boss monster. Archer was prepared to exact revenge on his comrade. However, RMC stopped him. Q forewarned him that he would fight this monster carelessly. He'll become just like his pal. Their leader agreed with Q's remarks. The power of this monster was beyond their capabilities. He learned that it would take an additional 3 hours before they could use the portal, so he plans to hold this monster until it opens up again. He was aware that their fight couldn't last very long. The creature began to move as well. Once more, it made use of its web to enter the leader's arms. The archer attempted to assist, but his blows were ineffective. The monster then turned its attention to him as well. The archer was then drawn toward her by the monster. Then its vicious teeth emerged. There was nothing the archer could do about it. The creature had her for lunch early. Their leader was incensed by this incident. Then he gathered his strength and cut the monster's webs. But something stopped his blade. This level 4 monster was simply too powerful. As a level 3 swordsman, his attacks were simply ignored. Then the monster regained his hands. And he's the one being tugged now. I then yelled for him to hand over his sword. He informed the leader that he would give Q-Cat his hand if he wanted to live. He was aware that he had no other option. The leader hurled his sword in Q's direction. The leader let out a painful scream as RMC immediately severed his arm because it was the only thing that could save the elderly man. Q then assisted him in getting some distance away from the creature. Zixi then treated her leader by using her abilities. This woman, meanwhile, was already in a panic. Because she didn't want to die, she then fled. Q was asked by 20 why he wasn't following suit. Because it tastes here, RMC informed her that the monster was simply letting her prey run. Before killing them, the monster wants them to experience fear. These creatures were referred to as God-chosen beasts. They were fed on the negative emotions of people, such as envy, fear, and resentment. Q goes on to clarify this to Zixi. These monsters were endowed by the gods outside of reality, which is how they gained greater strength than other monsters. Because he had already vanquished hundreds of these monsters in a previous incarnation, RMC was aware of this. However, he had no idea that the system would send him into a realm where this particular kind of monster already existed. This beast, chosen by God, began acting strangely once more. It spread throughout the area after releasing a toxic gas. Fortunately, Zixi was present and possesses a talent that could ward off the poison. This woman was now in trouble in the meantime. She bolted, out of reach of Zixi's abilities already. As soon as she inhaled the poison, she passed out. However, as Zixi was only a level 2 healer, she was unable to withstand the poison gas pressure. This monster was beginning to feel content, but it then picked up on something. Q had already vanished from his place. He informed the creature that although his abilities had vanished, his spirit and soul remained at level 14. that allowed him to survive the poison gas. While battling in this realm, our MC also picked up a new ability. He began to change in appearance as he used his skill. Our MC has just changed into a monstrous creature, and he informed the monster that it had cause for pride as it would see his newfound strength. More potent poison gas was released by the monster in Q's direction. However, our MC had already taken up position to sprint in the direction of the monster, and he was gone in an instant. The monster was in a hurry to respond. It suffered severe harm at the hands of Q. One leg of our MC was taken off. He was so proud of these legs that he even teased it. The monster attempted a counterattack, but to no avail. These two were simply too different in terms of power. Even so, Q was let down because he had anticipated more. However, our MC persisted in his attacks because he had to finish this quickly, and the god-chosen beast was subdued as was to be expected. It can now only support itself on one leg. Our MC really got into the habit of taunting his victim. This monster was aware of its lack of chance of victory over Q, that is the reason it began to flee. However, its other leg was amputated once more. The creature collapsed. She now had an octopus-like appearance. Q stopped Takoyaki as it attempted to crawl away. This is the new avatar of the greatest human hero, a monster that was capable of consuming every other monster on the planet. And with that, our MC's fight was over. He was then congratulated by the system for finishing the quest. As a bonus, he also received a spider foot, and he will now be returned to the actual world. Zixie was now meandering the streets 2 hours after the incident. She is still in shock at what transpired inside that realm. They had already left the secret realm by the time they woke up. The leader was hurried to the hospital as well. The other woman was unharmed as well. However, Zixie was concerned about Q because she hadn't seen him since. And after looking for our MC for a while, she finally found him in front of a structure. Our MC was transported to Das City by the system, and he's searching for a place to live at the moment. However, the monthly rental fee for a single room was already more than $3,000. Moreover, he had nothing for himself at the moment because these items had been given to him for free during his previous life as a hero. He had no money at all. Zixie yelled his name as he was contemplating how hard life would be for him going forward. This girl was the healer from the secret realm, Q recalled, and she became a little miffed that Q couldn't recall her name. Subsequently, she repeated her name. Then Zixie was the name of this girl. She was relieved to see Q safe and sound aside from that. She then saw that Q was examining this building's rental prices. She learned that because Q had no relatives in this city, he had nowhere to settle down. Zixie got to talking about Das City's past. This location was established following the disaster 40 years ago. The area saw fast development, and soon it was transformed into an urban village. Zixie gave Q a tour of her home after making him fall in love. Recently, this girl adopted RMC. There was a separate room for Q in her spacious home. In Zixie's gate, Q then noticed something. She explained to him that it was a medal her father had won for his heroism when he retired. His father participated in numerous battles as a level 5 melee professional. Zixie mentioned to Q that her father was able to engage in combat with masks. Q then asked her about her father, though she's not sure if this was true because her father often tells this story when he's intoxicated. As it happened, her father had already passed away. His body had suffered from the war. His father had lost too much energy, even if all the battle wounds had healed. Not long after he retired, he died. Then, RMC inquired about her mother. When she gave birth to Zixie's sister, she had already passed away. Q heard this and lost all ability to speak. Zixie, however, informed him that since everything had already happened a long time ago and she was doing well at the time, he didn't need to be wearing that expression. Q was then welcomed inside the home by her. To get him started, she will even give Q some clothes. After that, the girl indicated the room that Q could use. He was able to live in this spare room. This life was better, Q thought, than the one he had lived constantly on the front lines of the conflict. When he begins to receive money from the hidden worlds, he will also make sure to return her favor. And then a visitor arrived. The girl in the wheelchair was Kane Liu, Zixie's younger sister, and she was inquiring as to who Q is. Q's situation was also explained to her by Zixie. The girl didn't like her older sister inviting a stranger to their home, so she introduced Q as her companion in the secret realms. Then, Kane Liu disappeared. Zixie apologized to Q on her sister's behalf. She informed him that whenever her sister sees strangers, she becomes agitated. Additionally, the masks trial took place on this day. Kane Liu had a strong affinity for masks. Q never imagined that he would have so many admirers in the past. Kane Liu, meantime, had returned to her computer. This girl was occupied with being a keyboard warrior against all of the mask breakers. She didn't stop typing her responses to these trolls. Zixie yelled that it was time for them to eat after that. However, this girl truly had a strong commitment to her goal. Despite having a guest waiting for her, she refuses to eat. She also informed her sister that Q is not required to be welcomed. Zixie eventually gave up. They were eating too simple now, so she apologized to Qiu again. However, these foods were already good in Qiu's opinion. He recalled the occasions when he was made to consume unseasoned monster meat. In a previous life, he had to go through all of those experiences. He was thinking like a hero at that moment. He was prepared to put up with everything as long as it meant he could end world conflict. The news about Mask's trial was aired while they were eating. These two hosts were discussing the events of the trial. This one mentioned a theory regarding the disappearance of the mask. Online users claimed that the mask was nothing more than a front for him to give up his abilities. Ultimately, he simply vanished following the trial. The other person was more worried about the loss of humanity's greatest hero. He wonders if they will all be alright in the event of another calamity. It was clear that this man opposed masks. In his remarks, he was displaying bias. He expressed his confidence that humanity will once more withstand any calamity. He underlined that the world will continue to advance even in the absence of a mask. Zixi continued to be worried about the outcome of Mask's trial. She started to ask Qiu what his thoughts were on the matter, but she became sidetracked when Qiu finished eating so quickly. He was on his fourth bowl already. This guy was merely preoccupied with his meal and enjoying it. Zixi, though, persisted in telling him what she thought of the trial. She continues to believe that the mask is acting for a purpose. Qiu answers Zixi's thoughts with a lackluster response. She came to the conclusion that Qiu could care less about the mask. If only she had known that his guy was actually Mask, she would have smacked the television down as soon as her sister had learned about their idol. These two heard some sudden loud noises coming from outside. These yelling individuals identified themselves as Kaijiang Investment Company representatives. They persisted in their loud knocking, threatening to set this house on fire if no one answered the door. Zixi then sprinted in the direction of the door. These guys greeted her as she opened it. She went on to say that she had made up her mind not to sell the house to their business. However, the man went on to explain her circumstances to her. She recently lost her party as a result of their raid on the secret realm. She doesn't have a job. Zixi couldn't figure out how these thugs were aware of what was going on inside the realm. The man went on to tell her that their company was easily able to obtain information about them because of their connections to the government. This man was aware that Zixi would eventually be forced to accept their offer. He also gave her 5 days to think over their offer, warning Zixi that things would get problematic if she didn't comply. He made her an offer of $100,000 federal cash in return for her home. Zixi became perplexed once more because the previous offer was $3 million. It still doesn't make sense, even though she didn't intend to sell them this property. This guy was definitely making the most of his chance. He was pressuring them to accept his offer right away. He even made her consider accepting the deal by pointing out her sister's medical expenses. Kain Lu requires medical attention, which will be very expensive at this time. Zixi's bank account is worth less than $30,000. When Qiu then emerged, the man saw him. Then, believing that Qiu was Zixi's boyfriend, he greeted her. He made an attempt to shake hands with Qiu. He even gave him an introduction. This man is the head of the security division and goes by Tujin Kenzo. The gesture was accepted by RMC. Zixi informed Qiu about Kenzo's abilities before they could even shake hands, but it was too late. This guy is skilled at mental attacks, and he intends to employ them. His influence was used against RMC. Kenzo was about to attack here when he entered Q's mental realm. Since Qiu has been acting up lately, he was even considering giving him a minor concussion, but this guy started to get confused. After attempting to enter Qiu's consciousness for some time, he became aware of something. Qiu's mental world was this vast one. Since this was his first experience with a strong mental power, he is now terrified. Kenzo was forced to retreat as quickly as possible because of these enormous waves. The surf caught him. He believed that Qiu was a completely different animal. Qiu's mental force was going to eat this guy alive. RMC was free to do as they pleased. While he was being absorbed by Qiu's consciousness, Kenzo also witnessed this. He let out a scream upon realizing what he truly saw. When he returned to reality, Kenzo was gone. Zixi was unaware of what was going on. The other bodyguard, who was in charge, stopped the other bodyguards from attacking Qiu because their leader had just passed out. This guy was aware of how powerful Qiu was compared to them. Based on how he dealt with Kenzo while attempting to support his boss, he believed that Qiu might be a level 3 professional. Zixi was informed by this guy that their liaisons were far from ended. Despite the fact that they initiated the problem, they even have the audacity to suggest that things will not be simple if someone causes problems with their people. Zixi asked Qiu if he truly had done that to Kenzo after they had departed. Qiu informed her that Kenzo was to blame for attempting to enter his head. RMC wasn't even planning on hurting him in that way. Qiu later learned that they have been harassed for the past 4 years by the Kaijiang company. Their desire to purchase their home was strong. They persisted in bothering them despite Zixi having previously informed them that they would not be selling the house. When she is not incarcerated, they even threatened to harm her sister. This only ceased when her leader intervened to save her. She is certain, though, that they will pursue them once more now that this good man is in the hospital. Qiu then questioned her regarding the government's early favoritism, starting with the passage of this bill when he was still a hero. Then it became known that Xixi's family had not received anything of the sort. These shark companies were also supported by the government. This was the only occasion Qiu learned that his rules from his heroic days were not being correctly carried out. Qiu assisted Xixi in doing the dishes following that incident. For now, this was the only way he could assist them. Xixi expressed her gratitude to him by telling him that Qiu had driven the thugs away. She went on to question him about his intentions for the secret realms and whether or not he would join other groups. And Xixi is in the same situation. She will have no choice but to join other parties if her leader doesn't wake up soon. But nowadays, going out with other people was kind of risky. Some groups even betrayed their own members in order to increase their loot. Mask had already put into effect a rule forbidding professionals from killing one another. But nobody could truly tell what was going on until they entered the realm. She assured Qiu that she would undoubtedly recommend Qiu to any trustworthy parties she managed to find. Qiu accepted her recommendation. However, our MC knew deep down that it would be impossible for him to join other professionals since he chose the monster path. He also understood that no sane person would fight beside a monster such as himself, and the system alerted him once more as he was completing the dishwashing. Once more, it was a level 4 secret realm quest. However, the primary prerequisite for this was that Qiu had to pass this on its own, and he has just 12 hours to get ready for this. After some time, in this hidden world, a portal materialized. Qiu emerged through the portal. This was the hidden domain he had to conquer on his own. He also expressed gratitude to the system for allowing him to travel in and out of the realms without requesting permission from the government. Our Mac observed that the layout of this realm resembled the middle ear of Europe. He also saw these enormous statues of gargoyles. The stone began to crack as soon as he locked eyes with these statues. And soon after that, the stone gargoyles changed into monstrous scarlet gargoyles. He then began examining the traits of these monsters. He believed that many people would be killed if Xixi's team came across these monsters. Without wasting any more time, the gargoyles charged Qiu, but Q's hand simply stopped them in their tracks. Our MC transformed back into a monster, and now that the real monster was going to destroy these monsters, he felt sympathy for them. And with that, two gargoyles were dispatched by RMC. As Qiu kept exploring this realm, he came across numerous gargoyles once more. He even issued an immediate challenge for them to charge him. The creatures took to the air and surrounded Qiu this time. RMC will do something different from the superhero landing pose he performed earlier. Qiu leaped up as well, and with a single blow, he vanquished each of these gargoyles one by one. And then, after a while, RMC started tearing apart the gargoyle's wings with one punch. When they faced Qiu, even these stone monsters were capable of experiencing fear. Once you vanquished the final gargoyle, something dropped. It was the monster's leader. It was dubbed the Stone Statue of Luck. Qiu said that this one appeared to be more human-like, and as a result, Qiu was even more determined to kill it. These two then sprinted in the direction of one another. Then silence engulfed the room. Someone eventually unlocked the door, and these experts arrived prepared for a battle. But all they were left with was an abandoned room filled with debris. This guy didn't understand why they were the first team into the dungeon, as they had been informed. It was rather strange that someone had entered before them because the entrance had been closed when they arrived. When the woman began to look around, she discovered one of the gargoyle bodies. She informed her leader that this person was a true monster. The irregular texture suggests that the damage was not caused by a sharp sword, implying that the body was torn apart in order to achieve this. Just thinking about it was enough to make their bones tingle. This fight was almost too much to handle with just bare hands. However, this man then noticed something that might support the reality of what had happened. This room had a body pinned to one of the pillars. Qiu used its spear against the monster that was leading the others. Meanwhile, these guys were receiving a lot of complaints at the Secret Realm Inspection Bureau office in Das City. The number of people reporting that the dungeon they were meant to clear had already been completed by someone else infuriated this boss. However, there have already been 7 reports, and this cannot continue as it indicates that they disregarded their official duties as officers. However, this individual believed that this was not a good thing because secret rounds were ultimately meant to be cleared. The fact that this guy failed to see the wider picture infuriated the boss even more. It was decided to clear the secret rounds, but not from those who avoided their security. This also jeopardizes the professional's security within the dungeon. There won't be an issue if the unregistered individual just kills monsters inside. But what if his primary intention was to surprise the experts? This will significantly elevate the hero community. The boss then informed his group that, in his day, the majority of heroes who ventured into the dungeon escaped unscathed by the monsters. Their friends betrayed them in order to increase their wealth and power. He began to consider the circumstances as well. The dungeon where the gargoyles were torn apart was where it all began. The infiltrator appeared to be at least a level 4 or 5 professional, based on the reports. Because there was only one pattern in the way the monsters were vanquished, they also ruled out the possibility that this was done by a group of professionals. And based on this knowledge, the boss deduced that whoever is responsible for this will attempt to sell the loot he has amassed in the market. He then gave his group the mission of searching the city's markets for people who had taken the same loot from the dungeons through infiltration. Meanwhile, this shopkeeper was happy to do business with someone at Da City's professional trading market. Q was that. He did, in fact, sell the loot drops to these stores, and he made a respectable profit. Additionally, since this was only a bonus for finishing his quest, he wasn't particularly concerned with the price he was selling. However, Q was now able to pay his rent and assist Zixi with this money, and from somewhere he heard a voice he knew. Zixi was there, attempting to upsell the shop on something. She was being pressured by the shopkeeper to sell her antique sword for a significantly lower amount. He informed her that it would only be worth a scrap because it was too old. The only treasure she currently possessed was this blade, which belonged to her father. She is now depressed because this item is now merely seen as a scrap. When he saw how miserable she was, the store owner offered to buy it from her for $3,500. Previously, his offer was $3,300. Zixi had already begun to consider it. Although she really didn't want to sell it, she must raise the funds necessary to cover her sister's medical bills. Regarding the shopkeeper, he was attempting to profit from Zixi's ignorance of the goods she was offering. This kind of sword is exclusive to high-level secret realms and would fetch a price tag of $10,000 easily. Then, fearing Zixi might change his mind, he attempted to exert more pressure on Zixi to sell the sword right away. But a voice then raised itself. Q was that. He examined the sword Zixi was grasping, and he was aware that this was a professional long blade with level 5. He expressed his desire for this equipment to Zixi. The store owner yelled at him, accusing RMC of stealing his Zixi transaction. And afterwards, Q made the decision to give Zixi the cash he had made from the dungeons. Considering the amount of money, the shopkeeper gave in. These two then made the decision to sit down somewhere in the park. Q is holding the sword at this moment. Zixi informed him that since he had already been of great assistance to her, she could give him the sword for just $1,500. But Q turned down her offer to trade. He informed her that she was entitled to keep all of the money since it was his way of saying thank you for the lodging and the delectable meals she prepared. Q demanded that she accept the cash. Our MC informed her that the blade was more intricate than she initially believed. This sword is easily worth more than $10,000. Zixi went on to say that since they were both secretive, this blade was a perfect fit for him. She had been considering the enigmatic events surrounding Q. This guy has made a lot of money quickly after managing to get out of the secret realm they were in previously. However, she ensured that she would be interfering with Q's behavior. All she wanted was for Q to be kind enough to actually look after her father's valuables. Flying Crow was the name of the sword. I felt that was a pretty fantastic name for a sword. It resembles a dangerous crow that was waiting for an opportunity to strike while hiding in the shadows. Zixi also admitted to Q that she was genuinely opposed to selling the sword. It was her only option. She also talked about her younger sister's tragic experience. Kamlu was incarcerated in the city at the time of the Great Ghost Incident. This magnificent ghost wreaked havoc throughout the city as a level 10 monster. Many lives were sacrificed by the professionals and the government army in order to vanquish this monster. In this incident, her father lost his life, and his Flying Crow sword was the only item found during this catastrophe. The radiation that was released into the city was the most lethal aspect of this incident. That day, the sky even turned green. Kainlu was also impacted by the radiation, causing damage to both of her feet. She was close to the radiation's edge. Zixi also mentioned that the Kainlu were a sword-wielding genus. She could easily level up to swordsmanship level 5 or above. But after her accident, everything changed. And in order to stop the radiation from entering her body, she now required ongoing care from highly skilled healers. Zixi had to give up her career in close combat as well because she needed a job with a higher survival rating. Q recalled this occurrence. It was he who used a single blow to vanquish the Great Ghost. But he didn't deploy for 10 hours. He had no idea how many lives would be affected by that incident in such a short amount of time. We learned why RMC detested the monsters so deeply. Q recalled as well that Mask struck an agreement with the federal government to provide support to all the families impacted by that particular incident. But Zixi was completely unaware of it. And now that she had shared this load with Q, she felt better. They ought to go back home right now, she informed Q. She will also prepare Q some delectable food. and they continued their journey. Additionally, Qiu passed by these two men as they searched for the loot drops from the dungeons where they had infiltrated. They had no doubt that the loot would soon be sold on the black market. Meanwhile, Kane Liu remained occupied in the Xixi home, battling online trolls. She then heard a loud knock on their door, though. The knocks were so hard that she believed this was not her sister. That's when she thought of the men from the Kaijiang Investment Corporation. The blows continued to intensify. As soon as Kane Liu saw her wooden stick, he seized it. She moved in the direction of the door. And that's when the guy with the kick opened it. The man enters the house and gives a friendly greeting to Kane Lai. Kane Liu became irritated and attempted to swing her sword. However, she was unable to deliver a strike. She collapsed as well, and then the guy trod on her weapon. He was aware that Kane Liu couldn't harm him because she couldn't get to him. Then, this boss gave his men orders to find Xixi and the person who had injured Kenzo the previous time. These criminals began to turn over and damage the entire house. And after that, these louts claimed not to have located Xixi and Qiu. He then made the decision that since they couldn't leave without Kane Liu, they would just take him with them. The other guy warned his boss that they might face kidnapping charges, so this was not a good idea. Instead, the supervisor gave this guy special recognition and a task. He gave him the keys to a truck and told him to drive it to Zixi's yard as soon as she and her boyfriend arrived. The manager intended to throw trash in their yard and report it as a small mishap. These guys laughed at the idea and seemed to like it. It started to rain heavily after a while. Xixi and Qiu continued to sprint in the direction of their home. However, Xixi noticed something. Still lying on the ground, she noticed her younger sister. Just left there in her pathetic state was Kane Liu. Xixi hurriedly ran to assist her sister. Kane Liu informed them of the events. It was the Kaijiang Investment Company, she claimed. After that, Qiu helped Kane Liu enter the house again. But a loud crash was heard shortly after. It was the vehicle, and all of the trash was thrown in front of them as it really crashed into their yard. Xixi refused to back down. Whoever did this, she already knew. The man even made an attempt to mock them by saying that it was all a mistake. Since Xixi was already standing in front of it, he also advised her to clean it up. After that, Kane Liu attempted to console her sister. Qiu stopped her, though. He instructed her to give her sister some space. He said that if her sister persisted, it would only make her sister sadder. Xixi kept her head held high as she entered their home. But she didn't speak to them at all. Qiu and Kane Liu were subsequently left outside the house. Liu then questioned Qiu about why they were experiencing these kinds of things. She questions whether justice actually exists in this world. Qiu informed her that it never existed. Liu continues by pleading for even a semblance of justice or hope in their society. And RNC gave her the real scoop. In actuality, these things don't exist. Even the rain, he said, falls on different people. With her sword in hand, Qiu informed her that rain falls on the oppressed and the wicked. He continued by telling her how unfair the world truly was. This little rain was evidence of that even. RNC was obviously irritated by what transpired. With just his grip, he broke Kane Liu's wooden sword. Kane Liu began to cry because she was unable to control her emotions. Qiu informed her that the issues facing her family paled in comparison to the global issues, and their extramarital affairs don't really bother him. However, since trouble was always trailing RNC, he decided to take action. Kane Liu inquired as to his destination. Qiu threatened to kill these people, he told her. When she heard his response, the girl became frightened because she believed that she couldn't defeat them. Level 3 to 4 fighters are among the company's roster. She also reminded him that their issues weren't serious enough to warrant attention. RNC concurred that this was essentially a small issue. Rather, it amuses him. However, the truth is that he enjoyed doing mundane tasks like this, particularly when using violence to solve these issues is an option. It was a soggy afternoon that day. Qiu was waiting to launch an attack in front of the structure. The experience within this establishment was sumptuous. In case anyone caused any trouble, it was also manned by powerful bodyguards. Qiu entered the structure and notified the guards right away. However, it appeared as though they even desired some trouble rather than being afraid. These two came up to Qiu and ordered him to put down his gun. However, RNC continued to walk. He seemed to have taken action already. This guy had been slashed in the space of a second. Already, these two had become dust. Additionally, the system assigned Qiu a new mission. To eliminate every hostile creature within the building, he had to use the Flying Crow. Additionally, the sword will receive an upgrade as a reward. More guards were then sent in to stop Qiu and he kept moving in their direction. One of the guards advised his friends to exercise greater caution. And so they encircled Qiu. These guys launched their offensive. RNC grabbed them with a quick motion. And this guy was about to hit too. But his aura was already noticed by RNC. Qiu gained his arms by using his sword, and he went straight after his body. But Q's blade became lodged. Already, Flying Crow was boring. The others realized this and were going to take advantage of this knowledge. Qiu decided against using his sword and instead used his fist. This guy wasn't expecting this. He was aware that Qiu was a weapon user, but he was physically stronger than those fighters. Qiu then received his sword once more. He persisted in his attempt to murder these men. Meanwhile, the man who had visited Zixi's house was lounging at this office. He believed those two sisters would eventually sell them their property. If they were able to redevelop the property, these guys were already anticipating big profits. However, this guy suddenly entered and informed his boss. He informed them that a man was already en route to them and that someone was murdering all of the guards. Even though there is just one intruder, he has already killed the majority of the guards. At this point, the man was considering who they had messed with. They always take care to avoid getting involved with powerful individuals or high-level professionals. He gave his men orders to investigate the true situation. They went outside and took every weapon they owned. Then they noticed something. There was a man pleading for his life on the stairs. However, he encountered this black cut, and Qiu appears from the steps at that point. The aura of RMC intimidated this boss very quickly. In an attempt to appear tough, he told his men that they shouldn't be afraid of a single guy because they were all accomplished professionals. These three had readied their weapons and themselves. They requested Qiu to simply give up because they were level 4 professionals. The other man identified him and informed his superior that Qiu was the one who had rendered Kenzo unconscious. And on their most recent visit, he was at Zixi's house. Qiu reasoned that using his human form alone would not be an easy task when facing three level 4 professionals. The lights in the hallway then went out after RMC destroyed these light switches. These guys already believed that Qiu was going to trick them into believing something. However, the man informed him that he didn't mind the dark because he had turned on his night vision ability. After his eyesight gradually corrected, he noticed something strange. The man they had been battling with earlier had vanished. And there's a monster in front of them right now. This guy sensed the evil energy surrounding them. He noticed Qiu moving, but it was too late. The flying crow had already eaten him. When their boss attempted to call this man by name, all he received was a bloodstain. He wants to know if his friend has passed away already. They witnessed this horrifying scene when lightning struck something close to the building. Qiu was prepared to attack right away. This guy managed to thwart Q's endeavor. He was aware that he would have died by now if he had responded a little more slowly. Casting an ice arrow, the blonde guy used his ice skill. However, Qiu was aware of his attack. RMCC used only one hand to block this potent attack. He used his grip to smash it as well, and he now turned to face the assailant. Their leader heard the blood all over the place. Before their leader could even address Qiu, Qiu was already holding one head, and his head was already off. It is obvious that the greatest human hero has chosen the path of the monster. Now covered in blood, the flying crow was terrified for their lives and the reinforcements who had come to aid their boss. They were unprepared for the monster they would encounter today. The monster was right in front of them when they realized that it had abruptly disappeared from their visions. A few seconds later, Qiu had already attended to them. This guy told Qiu to stop there. RMC was aware that this man was unique among the group. This individual was a professional level 6. This expert believed that the creature before him was merely casting a spell of some sort that altered its appearance. However, it exhaled like a demon. So, this theory was already disproven. After that, he descended the stairs gingerly. He explained to Qiu that he is a very rare monster because he is halfway between a human and a demon. In order to make up for all the losses he suffered from today's encounter, he now intends to track down Qiu. This professional moved and briefly disappeared. He approached RMC and pointed. Qiu managed to avoid it, but he was only slightly hurt. Qiu's ability to sidestep his attack impressed this professional right away. Although he complimented Qiu's quick reflexes, the purpose of the first attack was simply to test Qiu's limits, and he carried on attacking Qiu because he had already obtained the information he required. This man possessed great strength. He was able to cut several people throughout Qiu. He was already having fun because he had a formidable opponent. However, he realized that this monster would be defeated by his next move. This guy charged right at Qiu. Although RMC easily avoided it, this was merely a trap. This man just pulled a gun on a monster. He succeeded in landing a clean hit on Qiu after clicking it. He was very happy that this method never missed a shot. He used this on every monster, and they were all blasted to bits. He's now considering the possibility of selling this monster for a large sum of money. But Q's head was still intact as the dust settled. This expert finds it unbelievable that a monster could withstand that blow. Now he wonders how this monster escaped his attack. Q spoke and identified the method this person had employed against him. The name of it is 19 rapier style. Q complimented this guy for having mastered this method to such a high degree. Since he created this method, RMC was aware of it. This method was especially created by him for rapier users. However, since Qiu created this, he was aware of how to counter it. Additionally, he stated that only the righteous should employ this method, and this individual has been misusing it. He didn't get Q's comments because, in his opinion, he had used it to defeat a monster. Qiu gave this expert an explanation of the circumstances. he informed them of the families whose lives were destroyed by this investment firm. In response, this expert said he didn't really give a damn about them, because even if those people were left in ruins, the world would still turn around. And that was the guiding idea that this man was discussing. He then carried on with his mission to eliminate Qiu, and Qiu has made a decision based on his perverted principles. These claw-like growths appeared behind our MC's back. The level 6 professional avoided the weapon even though he wasn't expecting it from Qiu. The next attack came too quickly for us to respond to. This was all the opportunity Qiu needed. This guy was then subjected to a torrent of attacks. It was him after a few more seconds. One final query was posed by this guy to Qiu. What kind of monster was Qiu? He inquired. When our MC responded to his query, he pulled out his sword once more. He informed him that Qiu had previously proven his identity, and the flying crow was covered in blood once more in an instant. Then, Qiu saw that it began to glow. The flying crow has recently changed into the blood raven. The limitless growth potential of this weapon was one of its abilities. Although nothing about its appearance changed, our MC sensed that something inside of it was different. His weapon seemed to have its own pulse these days. He believed that because there was so much potential for growth on both sides, this was truly the ideal weapon for him. Qiu then noticed another guy who was even more terrified than the first. Though our MC had turned into a monster, he attempted to beg Qiu not to kill him. It was no longer the same as being a hero in his morals. He then fed this treat to Blood Raven, his recently upgraded weapon. This guy was easily devoured by the sword slash. Its power was visible outside and it even destroyed the building. Additionally, a special task force was already in place while all of this chaos was occurring within the building. According to this officer, they had already encircled the area. They were notified of the situation by someone, and they arrived to apprehend the infiltrator. The commander of this operation instructed his troops not to launch an attack beforehand. They'll hold off in the hopes that the suspect will come to a compromise with them first. This elderly man was aware that none of the victims who died within this structure were blameless. It was they who destroyed thousands of lives. But while they waited outside, he still had work to do. One of the officers noticed someone leaving the structure. This is MC, and there is a lot of blood all over his clothes. When Zixi finished her bath, she learned that Qiu had arrived at Kaijong Investment Company. This girl was about to stop Qiu and she quickly grabbed her umbrella. She noticed the hordes of police that surrounded the area as she made her way towards the building. One of the officers pulled over her and inquired as to whether she was 20. He informed her that she was required for an ongoing investigation. The officer then displayed a photo of Qiu to Zixi. She introduced herself as someone who knows Qiu and inquired as to his whereabouts and continued existence. The officer informed her that he is more than just living. The Qiu was doing well. Qiu was detained and allowed inside the City Defense Army's exclusive prison. This elderly man had been watching RMC's actions for some time. According to this guy, Qiu had already admitted to attacking the Kaijong Investment Company. But after that, all they had to go on was his name. They know nothing about this guy other than that. It seems as though he materialized out of thin air. Additionally, there are no government records pertaining to him. He was related to only one person, Zixi. They discovered that these two had met inside the secret realm when they questioned the girl. They then explained his identity in relation to the enigmatic insider of the hidden domains. The elderly man thought Qiu was very mysterious. He inquired as to 20's identity next. He discovered that Zixi was only a level 2 healer and that her father was a level 5 professional in the military. He was also informed that Zixi's sister had been caught up in the long-ago calamity that had struck the city. This girl told them how she got to know Qiu. She informed them that just as her group was ready to take control of a hidden domain, Qiu materialized from the entrance. The other party members who made it out of the realm agreed with her statement as well. This commander also learned that Qiu attacked the Kaijong Investment Company as a result of the latter's persistent attempts to pressure Zixi's family into selling them their property. Then this director walked into the room. He informed the commander that they should now speak with Qiu directly. The director was a level 6 professional, and Commander Jian was a level 7 professional. These two were regarded as the city's strongest. The Qiu's room door opened. The commander noticed Qiu's look right away, but he didn't realize RMC wasn't facing him. He was examining his cloak's badges. After that, the commander took a seat and began the interview. He informed Qiu of the repercussions for the recent crime he had committed. Qiu might receive a death sentence and be forced to serve in the battalions on the front lines as a sacrifice for his transgressions. Only after serving and enduring these combat missions will Qiu be granted his freedom back. However, as far as anyone knows, this amounted to simply carrying out a death sentence. Nobody had ever made it out on the front lines alive. Fighting monsters on the front lines wasn't exactly a punishment for RMC, though. In his former life as a hero, he had been doing this all his life. Qiu's statement caught the commander's attention. When he inquired whether Qiu had prior frontline experience, Qiu replied in the affirmative. The commander and the director exchanged glances. They were aware that there is a genuine mystery surrounding Qiu. They could have been aware of Q's identity if what he was saying was accurate, because the odds of someone surviving that circumstance were very low. Then the commander informed Qiu that both he and the director had served on the front lines. The director was regarded as a seasoned professional in this field, and the commander had 10 years of experience serving on the front lines. Mask and the original group of heroes were the only ones who served longer than them. Even as proof, the commander displayed his mask medal. Additionally, Qiu should have known that he shouldn't have committed this crime in the first place because he was familiar with the experience of fighting on the front lines. The peace that has been being established for decades could easily collapse under these kinds of circumstances. Without the government's knowledge, Qiu had also been venturing into the forbidden territories. This could ruin their reputation as a secure company, so it was really a big deal. Despite all of these justifications, Qiu remained silent. He said nothing at all to these two. The commander then informed him that they were unable to assist him at this time due to his excessive disobedience. However, the old man continues to hold out hope that Qiu will eventually cooperate with them because the officers at the Federal Capital Prison will no longer treat him this way after he is moved there. Qiu was aware of the location of the Federal Capital and considered returning there. However, it was a little bit impossible at the moment. Recently, RMC was given a new mission. It concerns the Great Rebirth of Ghosts. A few years have passed since the catastrophe that befell the city, and the Great Ghost remained somewhat subdued. It now poses a threat to resurrect itself using the remnants of the last nuclear explosion it caused. The primary goal of the RMC was to stop the impending new disaster, and its core served as his prize. This was a manifestation of the Great Obscenity, or the Great Ghost. With powers comparable to those of professionals ranging from level 7 to 13, this monster belonged to the Calamity level. Way back when he vanquished it, Qiu already knew that this monster would soon come back to life. For this reason, he instructed the government to keep an eye on everyone who was impacted by the radiation at the time. Qiu put in a lot of effort at that time, and his only goal in life was to keep the world peaceful. He was moved around to different locations merely to protect them from various disasters. However, all he got in return for saving the city's citizens that day was verbal abuse. The people hated him even more after he arrived 10 minutes late. They made fun of him and said he wasn't appreciative enough of the people who had placed him in that predicament. This was the unflattering reality about people. But despite all of the hostility, Qiu consistently begged for pardon. It's not like it is this time. He is no longer required to be a hero. Humanity was simply too much. Qiu reasoned that whether or not people survive these days is not really important. He no longer gives a damn. These two were still speculating as to whether Qiu had actually been on the front lines. However, the elderly man informed him that he had never seen someone with that level of strength in his entire life. Because of the way he killed those people inside the building, Commander Zhang was aware of this. He was aware that Qiu was an expert in every fighting maneuver. It appears as though he simultaneously cultivated several classes. The commander was then questioned by the director if Qiu had ever been a genius. There weren't many people who had that level of strength. The elderly man then informed him that although Qiu might be a genius, giving up his freedom to obtain Kaizhong Investment Company was a move. They didn't merit it. The Federation once more had the final say in the case of Qiu. This was the federal government capital known as Star City, run by the same people who were behind Mask's trial. After humanity survived the Dark Ages, this was constructed. This city was once thought to be a symbol of humanity's rebirth, and it currently exists in a state straight out of science fiction. And these congressmen were fighting and freaking out at one of the city's offices. He's looking at the report that was handed to him when it's Yo again. Qiu's crime report was this. He believed that despite the young man's apparent talent, he still felt that Qiu should be punished for his actions. The real reason he wanted RNC to be punished was because the Kaizhong Company was one of his cash cows in Daw City, and he needed to do this to demonstrate his dominance to those other companies that were protected by him. He claimed that this posed a greater threat to society. Hyo then made the decision to lead Qiu into the front lines and send him to the monster retreat. This man was still unhappy with the decision. For Qiu to be executed in public, he needed it. He was worried that his supporters would abandon him, but he abruptly changed the meeting's subject. He is irritated since nobody has ever found Mask after he vanished during that trial. All of a sudden, the room was silent. It is currently the modern era. He could be easily found, and someone could report them right away to the media or to anybody. However, there's still no information regarding Masks. Hyo had no idea that the mask was standing in front of him. However, the other congressmen in the room were attempting, under a different guise, to suit their leader. They informed him that the mask was now powerless, and that was the point made by Hyo. In the courtroom, the mask could not just vanish in an instant if this were the case. Then this guy said that perhaps that was just from what little power he still had. Additionally, this was the propaganda that the populace has been exposed to over the past few days, and as a result, the number of mass supporters had dramatically dropped. Xiao relaxed as he took stock of the circumstances. He is the most powerful man in this federation at the moment. Xiao continued to tell them that they needed to find a mask for their mental well-being after that. The proliferation of monsters in the front lines was the next issue they had to deal with. It increased by 32% this month. Xiao came to understand the value of a mask in these kinds of circumstances. It will be difficult for them to subdue the monsters without him. Then, this guy questioned them regarding their decision in Mask's trial, asking if they had gone too far. This infuriated him because it seemed as though someone was doubting their group decision. Xiao continued to express his annoyance after that. He questioned the congressmen about whether they all believed that humanity would perish without masks, and in order to strengthen the troops' position on the front lines, he gave the order to lower the prisons for the soldiers in each city. That was not a good idea, this guy said. Every city had troops stationed there in case a disaster struck, and the defense of these impacted areas will be impacted if they carry out this redeployment. However, someone commented that the reason he opposed this action was because the man in question was in charge of arming the guards. And so their dispute began. However, they were unable to disagree with Xiao's decision, which was final. Since there hasn't been a significant disaster in these cities in many years, he is optimistic that they can now handle the risks. Regarding Qiu, Xiao desired that he be assigned to the defense forces building in the capital city, Das City. Zixi had had enough of collaborating with these cops. She took this action in an attempt to save Qiu, but she was essentially powerless. But this is not something that Chan Liu can accept. These sisters will be Q's main witnesses during his trial because he was accused of a serious crime. This woman officer was informed by Chan Liu that this was simply unfair. Only those deemed to be earthly scammers were subject to punishment by Q. She went on to say that Keeling was still wrong even in that scenario. This young girl clarified that the deceased individuals weren't even honorable citizens. Thousands of lives were destroyed by those guys. Commander Jian interrupted them after hearing what they were talking about. He told Chan Liu that her assessment of those guys is accurate. However, even if what happened to them was justified, Qiu still has no right to act in such a way. Then, Chan Liu questioned him about why, knowing that such things were occurring, the government had done nothing. The elderly man informed her that sacrifices would always be required and that occasionally there would be darkness that cannot be overcome by light. It's not like they didn't want to chase the darkness away, as Chan Liu hinted. Simply put, they are unable to. Commander Jian informed her that her individual disobedience was unfair, and she is unable to accept this assertion. She yelled that it was a mistake for this world to even exist. For now, all Zixi could do was look at her sister. After that, they concluded it would be best to simply return home. Commander Jian believed that Chan Liu could use her resentment to destroy all monsters in this world if only she could stand. They eventually made it to their house. Chan Liu still needs to clean their yard, so 20 left her in peace. Additionally, 20 will look for ways to assist Q. However, this girl's thoughts were elsewhere. She is still unable to accept the way the real world operates. She made the decision to be the light's beacon in any areas where it isn't able to reach. Chan Liu was able to get back to her feet. She managed to walk a short distance as well. Zixi, meantime, continued to work on tidying up. She saw her sister after that. Zixi was taken aback by this as her sister had hidden away. But there seemed to be a problem. As vines began to emerge from Chan Liu's arms, she motioned for her sister to begin running. Meanwhile, these guys were fighting at the security department headquarters because they had just received the notice that their police force was being reduced. Commander Jian personally scheduled this meeting to inform them of the situation and solicit their input. But then he had a sensation. Commander Jian recognized the aura he sensed instantly. He is certain the Great Ghost was responsible for this aura. These cops started to lose it. They even questioned their commander's accuracy. They believed that this disaster had been overcome a long time ago. Then the glass in their office was broken by this elderly man. He gave his men orders to launch the emergency military plan and get everyone out of the city right away. Meanwhile, everything was operating normally on the city's busy street. Because of these flowers, this man even noticed the arrival of spring. He felt that the arrival of spring was premature, but it wasn't spring that caused these flowers to begin to bloom. Pollen was released into the air by these plants. This bee became drawn to them and was ready to land. It changed as soon as it made contact with the flower. It's now time for this guy to cross the street, according to his friend. However, as soon as he looked up at his friend, something felt off. This man's body appears to be growing plants. His friend let out a shout, warning everyone in the vicinity, and the catastrophe began at this point. People were transforming into these plant monsters one by one. That's when this expert stepped in to save the day. People began to applaud him. Now that they were safe, they believed. This hero took aim with his weapon and delivered a powerful cut. His assault succeeded in slicing this enormous mound of petals. The monster appeared to have been killed by him. but then his arms also became vines. The monster they were up against had this contagious pollen, and they could tell this was a serious obscenity simply by looking at the disaster. These cops were already moving to put an end to this, since the corpses were becoming plants rather than rotting or disintegrating. Some of them even believed that this was not the great obscenity. Commander Jiang then introduced them to the term human flowers to describe this phenomenon. Additionally, he cautioned his group not to underestimate these monsters as they have the potential to evolve into even more dangerous beings. He gave them orders to guard every street in the area and ensure that this monster doesn't infect anyone else. His team promptly took their places and executed his instructions. People were still fleeing down this street because some of the human flowers had already devoured them. They heard Commander Jiang yell at them and give the order to kneel down. He inhaled deeply before performing a fireball jutsu. This old man was skilled with fire magic, and he employed a potent one. He launched an attack that engulfed the entire street. They set fire to the human flowers. Yet, it had no effect on the pollen's ability to spread to other people. At that moment, Commander Jiang realized that this monster possessed the same level of infection power as the Great Ghost. Das City was all but destroyed in a matter of hours. The vegetation had already taken over the entire city. The director went so far as to say that this place resembled green hell. The soldiers were having difficulty repelling the vines already. Additionally, Commander Jiang ordered his men to stop using their weapons against these objects because even a tiny fragment of the human flower's bodies could spread the infection to many others. After meeting the elderly man, the director was able to verify that the disaster was, in fact, the Great Obscenity. The last time it attacked this city, the director was incarcerated. Its immortality was the only explanation for its second coming. The director was informed by Commander Jiang that certain monsters possessed this characteristic. However, this monster would still require a great deal of time to regain its full strength, much like those demons undergoing rebirth. This time, the Great Obscenity took on a different form from its previous iteration. The previous time, it was all about devastation. These days, it's more about defending the Earth from people. Additionally, the director recalled something. He recalled that after Mask vanquished the monster, he gave the officials the order to ensure that all signs of the creature were eliminated. Although these officials granted Mask's request, it turned out that they had broken their agreement. Even the funds that the Mask had set aside for the victims' families were stolen by them. The director was aware that if those officials had carried out their duties, this would not have occurred. They have more important things to do right now, so Commander Jiang told him to just report this to him later. He then inquired as to where the greatest energy fluctuation was coming from his team. The director was already aware of the elderly man's intentions. He plans to make an independent attempt to stop the monster. Director Jiang was informed by Commander Jiang that he had to take action while the monster was still weak. It's not even at level 9 or 10 at the moment. This was their one and only chance to stop this all-powerful disaster that, if it reached its zenith, could wipe out humankind. There would also be severe consequences if he postponed this any further. The director was aware that he was powerless to stop his boss. Then he advised him to exercise caution. In the meantime, news of the events in the city began to spread throughout Star City. The reporters claimed that a monster of cataclysmic proportions had actually attacked the city when it was first reported on television. Additionally, a live broadcast of the city's current situation was available. A few of the commenters had already started searching for the hero they had betrayed. They sort of expected that Mask to show up and come to their rescue. Additionally, a few of them shared photos on social media. After some time, there were reports of fresh developments. There have been rumors that Commander Jiang was engaged in combat with the Great Obscenity already. They were gradually turning the tide against these monsters under his command. This was the strange feed that the entire nation was watching. These enormous vines were pursuing Commander Jiang, as everyone could see. But he abruptly stopped moving after that. As it happens, the elderly man made it to his destination. He discovered the primary cause of this catastrophe. He identified this monster's face with ease. This person bears the responsibility for all of these. Chan Liu, Ziki's sister. Then Commander Jiang ordered her to give up acting. She even makes people worship her with her majestic appearance. There were monsters who claimed to be gods back in the early days of the Monster War. After deceiving the populace, these false prophets were worshipped. The director made an effort to reach his supervisor. He explained to him that the creature before him was the Great Ghost's reincarnation. Chan Liu had left already. Commander Jiang had no idea that she would turn into this exact disaster only a few hours after they first met. He was asked if he regretted it by Chan Liu. Regarding this old person's response, it was very evident. He began to gather strength and yelled that he was sorry he hadn't killed her at that moment. It was then that Commander Jiang moved. He sprinted over to Chan Liu. His speed was like lightning, and he got to the monster fast. He succeeded in landing a clean hit. His abilities impressed the reporters covering this fight. They believed that Commander Jiang had vanquished the monster with a single blow. However, as he pivoted, he realized his assault had been ineffective. Chan Liu began to grow again. She informed Commander John of the futility of this. This monster had fully recovered after a short while. The reporters were astounded as well. They were unaware of the true situation. The elderly man attacked once more. He threw these lightning-fast punches at Chan Liu, and each one connected. But his efforts were in vain due to her rapid regeneration. She inquired of the commander whether this was the same sunlight that he had mentioned previously that could chase away darkness. Commander Jiang became aware of the fervor for blood all around him. He started to move away from them right away. However, as he continued to consider how dangerous he felt, he heard a voice behind him. He attempted to run away once more, but Chan Liu was already behind him. And with that, this monster began to mock the light of which he was so proud. There is nothing he can do to stop this monster's power. It was obvious he was superior. Commander Jiang is stuck somewhere, because, provided there were planned surprises, this monster could simply teleport its body. The director then informed his boss that he must temporarily withdraw. Even for him, this match was too much. He recommended that they simply carry out a massive assault to level the entire region. However, the commander informed him that he was out of luck at this point. Commander Jiang removed his cloak, reasoning that he had nothing to lose. Grinning, he held his mask badge once more. It triggered a memory for him. He didn't give up just yet, which is why Chan Liu gave him praise. And based on appearances, this elderly man gained more power. Around his body, the blue lightning turned red. His final, desperate action was this. Then a massive red lightning struck his body. In an attempt to increase his abilities even further, the old man was trying to overburden his body with elemental attributes. But everyone was aware of the drawbacks of this tactic. After using it, one might end their own life. He just achieved level 8 power with this move, and Chan Liu, who was also aware of this phenomenon, praised him once more. The only drawback was that his body's cells were experiencing an energy overload. And eventually, cells were being destroyed because they are still unable to handle it. But none of that matters to this old man anymore. He shot back towards Chan Liu at a faster pace. She reasoned that she could just teleport herself immediately, so this was pointless. However, her body was on the verge of disintegrating before her mind could even register the thought. The elderly man was now quicker than her rate of thought. The old man was running out of time with this. His body was already breaking down into cells. He's going through a lot of pain in the process as well. Now that the reporter believed Commander Jian had finally vanquished the monster, he was joyful once more. However, this was untrue. The great ghost's energy hasn't vanished yet, rather, it's only getting stronger. Then the director told his men that this was no great obscenity, this monster. Then he informed them about the Antaeus creature. This creature, who originated from the dark ages of Greek mythology, was said to be unbeatable as long as the earth endured, and came to the conclusion that this being was Antaeus himself. It cannot be defeated at all as long as someone hasn't totally removed the powers it absorbed from the people it absorbed. All these plants and vines that it created contain the monster. She has 10,000 as well as winds. However, he was still unable to comprehend what their boss was saying. They were then presented with a fresh emergency alert. This monster was gaining energy very quickly. It even attained the Red Secret Realm's highest energy level. At level 9, Chan Liu was still developing her strength and power. Returning to the pair, Chan Liu finds it hard to believe that people could become this powerful simply by giving their lives. She had once dreamed of being strong enough to defend the defenseless. She went on to question Commander Jiang about why he had not used his authority to shield the people who were kept in the dark. When they most needed assistance, professionals abandoned them, which infuriated Chan Liu even more. She asked the world this question non-stop. Then all the human flowers and the vines surrounding the city withdrew. They were now converging on one location. Chan Liu has evolved into a new entity. She has now reached the height of the nearby buildings. Commander Jiang reappeared and prepared to respond to her query. He told her it was because of this world, all of his strength in his hands. That world helped him come to terms with the fact that death was nothing new. Commander Jiang launched a fierce attack with his red lightning. Chan Liu believed that she could easily use one hand to block this attack. However, that was untrue. Commander Jiang succeeded in getting through. People from all over the nation were following his fight. As soon as they saw that his attack had succeeded, they began to applaud. Chan Liu continued to attempt to thwart the old man's assault. But after a while, the strength that had rendered him essentially invincible began to wane. It is Commander Jiang's turn. She was holding him now. She told him he could go to hell because he had admitted to her that there was nothing unusual about being alive and dead in this world. Commander Jiang's eyes were filled with this last thought. Then he vanished. He was transformed into these petals, wafting through the air. He was informed by Chan Liu that this was the result of his trying the impossible. The director witnessed the events. Moreover, his boss's energy vanished. Everyone who was watching the live broadcast was taken aback. And it was then that they remembered the hero they had previously taken for granted. They had a mask search going on. A month has passed since his disappearance, and at this point, they are at a loss for what to do. These were finally heated by reality. At this point, a few of them began criticizing the federal government's decisions. The most often asked question that keeps coming up, Masker is where? Meanwhile, alarms began to go off at this prison facility. They were made aware of the monster with calamity level that had attacked the city. This is where Q was, and he was only holding off on acting until the right moment. He was now experiencing panic as all of this was going on. The heroes who vowed to serve under his leadership in order to defend the city are now unreachable. After the catastrophe, which occurred 1.5 hours ago, he has still not received anything. He was surrounded by a group of fearful individuals. Then, someone informed Yao that, initially, he shouldn't have been so merciless toward Mask, and he was struck by this remark. Subsequently, someone proposed that they should simply demolish the entire city permanently. These guys were simply excessive. They even took great pride in the notion of giving up a few for the benefit of many. Yao was now beginning to see these people for who they really were. They could not give a damn about the others. The idea that this was actually happening is beyond him. When he announced that something had changed in the city, this guy defused the situation. Yao inquired as to whether a professional had been sent to save the city. However, they learned of this strange occurrence as the reports began to come in. A monster arrived to assist the city. Back inside the private prison, this building was now completely slashed. The hole even extended to the building's lower levels. This guard was stunned, too. He reported to his friend what he saw as a monster emerging from the structure. Returning to the city, these soldiers continued to be the area's guardians. They became aware that the human flowers were resurfacing. A few of them took to their heels, realizing they had no chance against these beasts. However, the others carried out their duty and attempted to vanquish the human flowers. And just then, the squad's captain was being consumed by the vines. This man attempted to save his captain. But all of a sudden, a black aura passed him. The vines that were approaching were then destroyed by a series of slashes. It was now safe for the soldier and his captain. Chen Liu, meantime, was still in her enormous form. Just as the reporters turned to leave, something unexpected occurred. When the cameraman noticed someone, he assumed it was one of the reinforcements. Abruptly, an aura of red and black shot straight into the heart of the city. The populace believed that the federal government had sent this one. They hoped that Commander Jiang wouldn't have to die if this hero had arrived sooner. This one is still cutting his way in the direction of the large ghost. However, people noticed his appearance as they concentrated on him. Now that he's returned, RMC is here to finish the mission that the system assigned him. He must use his monster form to overcome this disaster once more. Q saw right away that there was a difference between the great obscenity of the past and the present. The former symbolized destruction, while the latter represented life. This new shape aims to consume everything in its path. It also desired to create a brand new world devoid of suffering and sanities, the most recent manifestation of absolute evil. But Q knew he still had to defeat this monster, no matter what form it took. This monster's core will aid him in his battles with the gods in the Void Realm. Our MC must go above and beyond. Chan Liu then set out on her mission to overcome all obstacles. She commanded all life to go and unite with her. Once again, this monster has spread its vines. She has now absorbed many souls and merged with them. However, one by one, the orbs began to pop, and a short while later, a significant portion of them were gone. Someone was killing her subordinates, as Chan Liu knew. Then she noticed that the creature was still slicing through her vines. Q was already familiar with her face. It was via Chan Liu that the monster had taken on human form. Nevertheless, Armic still rushed in her direction. It was unknown to Chan Liu that this monster was Q. She had no idea what kind of monster this was either. She attempted to expel this creature from herself. All Q needed to do was wait for this chance. Our MC leaped at the sight of her raised hand, delivering 1,000 cuts. He kept coming over to her after that. Then it seemed like these roses stopped Q. As soon as someone approaches them, they blow up. Fortunately, our MC moved quickly enough to avoid them. The public was kept informed about this development by the cameraman. This new beast was simply too swift. This professional, who was observing, started to feel afraid. This monster avoided every attack and explosion that it encountered. His agility, quick thinking, speed, and insight were all unmatched. Humans' intelligence and wisdom were the primary reasons they continued to defeat the monsters. But now something more akin to a monster with human characteristics had surfaced. He is now concerned about the day when monsters will be able to outperform people. Returned to Q, he had already approached Chan Liu. He unleashed another ability as he leaped for her. With the growth of his wings, the greatest monster humanity has ever seen was on the verge of vanquishing the formidable ghost. Chan Liu was shocked to see him grow his own wings. The fact that Q delayed using his wings in response to the explosion of those human flowers caused some confusion among the public. This expert went on to say that since it was unexpected, this was a really smart move. Q will have a better chance of confusing the opposition in this way. However, these were dangerous maneuvers as well. In these kinds of battles, only those who felt sufficiently confident about themselves could attempt it. Our MC slashed into the air while using the Blood Raven. It produced this ominous picture of a bird flying in the direction of his opponent. It fell onto its head. The cameraman was ecstatic to witness the effectiveness of Q's attack. The human flowers came to a halt as well as they ran toward Chan Liu. One person speculated that perhaps this indicated their victory. However, these talking human flowers soon stopped, and the same question is asked of them all. All of them wanted to know who Q is. Chan Liu had the same query as she was healing. Ultimately, they were all interconnected. She questioned the monster further about why he was holding the Blood Raven. Our MC remained silent. Then, Chan Liu realized that her opponent was a monster as well. Then she told him there was no need for a fight between them. Even so, the Great Ghost's new form offered Q her core as long as they cooperated. This is the Great Ghost's essence, and only those who were identified by this monster are permitted to use it. I found this offer to be quite alluring. Chan Liu persisted in convincing Q to accompany her in destroying and purifying the entire world. She suggested to him that they might fill the void that this world required. Everything could be altered by them. They could simply destroy the unsalvageable places and build new ones. She saw this disaster from a fresh angle, but her goal remained the same. Its goal was to end the world. This cameraman felt the sound of thousands of human flowers reverberating throughout the entire area. The fact that these monsters were now able to communicate with one another worries him. Q remained silent the entire time. Our MC had no desire to collaborate with anyone, be it with other monsters or with people. For now, all he could think about was one thing, and that is to eliminate every monster. He wasn't responding to Chan Liu, so she figured he didn't agree. She then instructed Q to make a decision regarding who should remain in this world. Chan Liu initiated contact. She applied her explosive ability in the same way as those human flowers. Our MC was able to stop this and shield his body from it. However, vines soon began to pursue him. Then it engulfed him. This time, Chan Liu simply had the advantage. She screamed loudly as soon as she was fully conscious again. Our MC closed his gargoyle wings once more in the interim. However, he destroyed the vines surrounding him by using its other form. He was about to be shallowed by Chan Liu. Fortunately, he was able to avoid it. Q moved around her with enough speed as well. In a previous life, he had already defeated thousands of giants and was aware of their weak point. They were hiding their true form somewhere inside that enormous body, and since it was not inside their heads, Q knew exactly where it was. Our MC kept flying in the direction of Chan Liu. He then slashed through this section using a Blood Raven once more. The vines continued to grow in an attempt to shield its main body. To eliminate Q, the Great Ghost even resorted to using its explosive ability. Despite being discovered for this move, Q persisted. He was aware that this was his opportunity to stop the disaster, and he also knew that this was the ideal location because it was making a great effort to defend this area. He continued to slice through, and soon after, he noticed something glowing inside. I knew this was the last one. After slicing through the final layer, he noticed this. It was Chan Liu's original body. The Blood Raven confronted the girl who had deliberately turned her body around. Although Chan Liu didn't think this monster could pull off the impossible, Q ran out of energy for his final strike. He was about to stumble already. He was about to fall until the vines of this disaster monster caught him. Now that this monster is in front of her, she is considering her options. Chan Liu even gave Q praise for hiding a handsome face. Q was unsure of how to feel. Then she told him to settle back. She admitted that she had already lost and that she was only holding on to this form with the energy that remained. The reporters assumed that they had lost this battle because of her massive body's continued standing. After that, he sensed trembling all around him. It was felt even by the soldiers and bystanders on the ground. Then they witnessed this object plummeting from the sky. It was a bright light, moving in the direction of the city. It's an atomic bomb. Yao gave his approval to this move. This was his final option. He felt remorse at this choice in the back of his mind. When Chan Liu and Q saw this, they instantly concluded that these monsters were incredibly callous. Here, they were prepared to surrender the civilians. Then, before she passed away, she made the decision to act morally. She desired for everyone to understand something. Chan Liu aimed to expose the nature of the individuals and the government to them. She went back to her enormous form, passing by the same people who had betrayed masks. The human flowers all began to move once more and formed a single entity. Chan Liu became bigger. She spread her arms out. They resemble enormous branches shielding the city from all threats. The public observed this. The monster from the apocalyptic level transformed into this enormous tree. The nuclear weapon that was about to heat the city was blocked by her. And after that, all they could see was this dazzling light. The human flowers crumbled as well. The impact of this explosion also caught Q. He was concealed by the Chan Liu's vines. Even so, she gave him last-minute protection. This occurred shortly after the city was heated by the nuclear weapon. The soldiers made every effort to shield everyone by raising this enormous shield. After that, the populace came to a realization. Instead of killing them all, this disaster monster shielded them from their government. These guys informed the director at headquarters that the Great Ghost's energy had already vanished. The director was shocked by this. Additionally, he addressed Commander Jiang, informing him that Das City was now safe. His death was not a pointless one. These guys are still in shock over what they witnessed. Some monster had come to their aid. The massive tree began to split open as well. It dispersed these exquisite petals all over the city as it sank. This woman thought the scene was pretty and tried to catch some of it. Someone informed her that these petals have the power to transform her into a monster. But nothing took place. She remained unaltered. Qiu was with Chan Liu in the interim. Embracing her, he held her. When Chan Liu awoke, she informed Qiu that she had never before understood how lovely spring truly was. And after that, she too gradually vanished. With this, our MC's mission is accomplished. He overcame the Great Ghost's reincarnation. Furthermore, he received the Great Ghost's core as payment. I compared it to a green heart. Since the core is also Chan Liu's heart, it has altered in form. Qiu then fitted his body with this core. He took in all of its energy, and Qiu was taken somewhere shortly after that. In the midst of the city, he disappeared. With the defeat of the city's calamity, everyone was happy. However, these human flowers reappeared as they all rejoiced. Then this took place. These humanoids became human, one by one. All of these individuals were taken in by the enormous phantom. What these guys saw astounded them. But eventually, they became aware of something. All of the human flowers at the nuclear weapon keeled were people. With this, the government's propaganda campaign resumed. On the internet, they disseminate false information. They even attributed this catastrophe to Mask. Some of these trolls even said that if the Mask had appeared immediately, this move shouldn't have taken place. Following that, the government removed all news and information pertaining to this issue. It seems as though people were forbidden from expressing their thoughts on this issue. In real life, similar occurrences were also taking place. When we realized that, it was truly depressing. These congressmen continued to hold meetings in the interim. They are currently talking about the social media precautions they have taken. They took great care to ensure that Mask would continue to be held responsible for this catastrophe. Ho continued to remain silent about the incident. It appears that this man had meticulous planning. In order to obtain Ho's position, they proposed using the nuclear weapon to kill thousands of people in the city. Then this guy appeared and took on the role of spokesperson for Ho. He went on to say that everyone in the meeting at the prison had agreed on that nuclear weapon. However, the primary issue was figuring out how to use this catastrophe as a chance. He really does intend to pin the Mask to everything. Then this guy butted in, saying that since Mask wasn't even in the city's prison, this plan couldn't work. They would use the same justification to win over the public's vote. They planned to disseminate rumors suggesting that they were compelled to take this action since the Mask failed to arrive to save the city. He also wished to add that despite all of the resources humanity had provided for Masks, he still declined to be their hero. This man truly embodied pure evil. He is a master at tarnishing someone's reputation in order to appear good. Everyone in the room was at a loss for words. Hyo and this man were left inside the room after that. He told Hyo that he now had control over everything. Hyo, though, acknowledged that he wasn't concerned about it. He came to the realization after this incident that humanity was still unprepared to face the monsters. They were still short-staffed. He then questioned the man about the setup for their newest experiment, which they were calling Morning Sun. This guy said that they have finally seen some successful subjects after hundreds of attempts. For extended periods, a few of the bodies were able to retain their monstrous forms. He assured Ho that their attempt to combine humans and monsters will eventually succeed. He added that they will be the ones to take humanity to new heights in his conversation with his president. Humanity will soon have access to everything. This map shows the location of the human-monster battle, even for the gods. This enormous landmass measured millions of square kilometers. Additionally, it was claimed that this formed all of Antarctica, South America, and Africa. This is where the Mask was last assigned. Here he led the people. However, monsters were appearing all around. This location was named the birthplace of calamity since it resembled their den. This was where all the monsters came from. Mask was the only man who was able to reopen this place for humanity. He was able to withstand the gods' wrath and even vanquish them. This was how that place was at the moment. In this thick forest, these four men were standing guard outside this portal. They needed to report something to their captain, which was why they were here. A silhouette emerged in the portal after a brief interval. The power of their captain was too extraordinary. Their captain completed the level 7 dungeon that awaited them in this hidden realm in under 30 minutes. This is their captain, right here. And she is regarded as one of the world's geniuses. She questioned her men about their peculiar facial expressions. After that, this guy went to report to his captain. It concerns the calamity that struck the city of Das. Was the issue resolved? She inquired. Although it was settled, her father's life was lost in the process. Jiang, the commander, upon learning this, she turned to leave and instructed her group to proceed to the next realm. They were all rendered speechless. Her father's passing didn't seem to have an impact on her mission. All these men worried about the state of their captain's mind. Although this woman had unrestricted control over lightning qualities, she was known as immovable ice. This was a result of her emotionlessness. When their captain overheard them discussing her, he chastised them. Secret realms spawn more quickly in certain places. They and other professionals don't get much time to relax. And for this reason, powerful teams were given the task of clearing more dungeons than anybody else. Every time, Captain Jiang navigates the secret realm by herself. But on this occasion, the men asked if she would like them to attend. Indeed, they make a point. In order for them to grow stronger, they also had to fight. Captain Jiang, however, got the impression from these statements that they simply questioned her abilities. Her team withdrew right away. Then, by herself, she entered the portal. Rather than take offense, these guys gave their captain even more praise. Someone with a very strong mental state would be able to accept her father's recent death and his continued monster hunting. She was seen by them more as one of the motionless monsters. This is the contents of the hidden domain. Captain Jiang entered without hesitation or fear. She saw something, so she stopped moving. Monsters lay there dead before her, all of them vanquished. At first, she believed that a small team had killed these monsters, but the same type of weapon had caused every wound. This implied that a single person had defeated them all. As soon as Captain Jiang heard something, she bolted in that direction. Then she spotted this enormous, menacing shark that looked like a human. This guy was being attacked by these monsters. Captain Jiang recognized this man as a low-level professional right away, despite the fact that every move he made was flawless. He was still able to dodge, block, and counterattack at the same time, despite carrying fatal injuries. She felt she ought to step in at this point. She materialized in front of the humanoid sharks with lightning speed. She too was able to take down these monsters with a single blow, and three monsters had already descended to the ground after a short while. Without wasting any more time, Captain Jiang asked the man to which team he belonged, but she received no answer. RMC was the person who was inside this forbidden world. Qiu's body gave up on him after this fierce battle, and he passed out. Captain Jiang was a little let down because she had believed she had found a powerful person she could respect. At that point, more monsters began to enter. Each of these guys was at a high level. She was forced to defeat these monsters at this point. She wrapped her lightning-skilled spear around it and wielded it. Captain Jiang recalled her father as well. He lost his life battling these beasts. This woman was enraged by what had transpired, and she directed her wrath at these monsters in her path. Her men were still waiting for her outside the portal. Their captain took a little longer to escape this dungeon, and now they were beginning to get worried. The portal then began responding, though. This indicated that their captain would soon emerge. When Captain Jiang emerged, she had a second man on her shoulders. Her men immediately wanted to know who this guy was with her and what had happened. Their group moved Qiu to this establishment known as N5. This is the location where experts gathered and regrouped following their conflicts within the forbidden areas. This area also has a posh hospital. Healers by profession were not very common. The doctors were assigned here with extensive training for this reason. Qiu was delivered to this establishment. His vital signs were likewise normal. The physician was astounded by how quickly he recovered. Despite the excessive damage to his body, he managed to live. Had they been regular people, they would have perished instantly. The Q's ability was said to be too extraordinary for Captain Jiang. Radiation was also present throughout Qiu's body. He currently has a scar on his face from that. The physician also informed Captain Jiang that although they would continue to watch him for radiation exposure, there was no risk to his general health. This man entered after their conversation. This person was Army Camp N3's supreme commander. He was Zhengai Liang. Captain Jiang stowed away right away. She discovered that Commander Liang was her mentor. In order to discuss her father, Commander Liang went to see Captain Jiang. The government honored those who gave their lives in defense of humanity with particular tributes. She remained silent when he informed Captain Jiang that her father had passed away honorably. Then he comforted her even more. The hero's daughter was approached by the media to be interviewed, but her mentor kindly declined. He informed Captain Jiang that, had he been the one inside, he too would have followed his father's reasonable decision. He advised her to question Qiu about the reason he's inside the secret realm before departing. This guy saw that Qiu was brandishing a sword, too. Anybody who could wield this sword, he claimed, was compelling enough. She then inquired about the sword, but the commander had already departed. She is forced to wait for Qiu to wake up for the time being. Qiu eventually opened his eyes. Qiu glanced around him quickly. With his gaze, Captain Jiang sensed something. She withdrew and grabbed her weapon right away. For the first time, she felt threatened by someone in that fleeting moment. Qiu calmed down once he realized what was going on. He He said to Captain Jiang that she could take off the Roman forebag he was wearing. Qiu asked her where he was as he sat down. He discovered that he is a member of the final group of camps. Since she was the one who had gotten him out of the hidden world, he also introduced himself to her. The brief small talk that followed brought the room back to silence. They turned to watch television now. News organizations resumed their campaign of disinformation against masks. The government continued to rely on Mask to fulfill his heroic duties. Jiang was a little pleased with the developments. She was aware that the government was getting agitated because they were once more blaming the mask. She was also astounded that these congressmen were still pursuing this hero despite his passing. Qiu was informed by Jiang that he was welcome to remain here as long as he didn't cause any trouble, even though she doesn't know who he is. She even gave Q's skills praise. However, she ensured that if the need arose, she would be the one to confront him. Then, RMC responded that she wouldn't be able to pull it off. She can't defeat him, he informed her. Captain Jiang became enraged but said nothing since she knew the truth of what he had said. She dismissed this, and she anticipates that this man will heal more quickly and resume his monster hunting career because he could even converse with her in that manner. She informed him that she would soon enter her next hidden realm because she doesn't actually have much time left. Her team was waiting for her outside the room. They all inquired about Q-related information. These men were very interested because Commander Lining had visited his room in person. Since this was their first encounter with the man, they were also curious as to which team he is a member of. After speaking with Qiu, their captain seemed irritated, and that was the only information they received from him. The name of this strange man was also disclosed, and Qiu emerged from his room, talking about the devil. It was too soon for RMC to leave, they all told him. Already, Qiu was making his way toward the hidden domain. Regarding his actual health issues, the great ghost's essence was expressing itself. It was still in need of more life force and more time to settle. To completely heal his body, RMC must kill and absorb more monsters. Jiang's group was still attempting to dissuade him from visiting the hidden realm right away, but they were stopped by someone. Commander Lining is it? He assured them that Qiu was free to pursue his interests. They had benefited from clearing secret realms after all. Additionally, no one could disagree with his choice because he is the camp's commander. Commander Ling was the object of RMC's attention, and this man followed suit. It states that Captain Jiang's team was then split into two if they could communicate with one another. On their missions, they'll be trailing both Jiang and Qiu. This woman, meantime, was already at the camp's gate. She noticed her team and they informed her that they had divided into two groups. These two reported on the events involving Commander Ling and Qiu. They were also perplexed because this was the first time they had noticed a friendly aura emanating from their commander. When Qiu was able to get up and leave the secret realms, Jiang confirmed that he did so right away. This information caused her expression to change. Then she assured her team that the man could take care of himself, so they didn't need to worry. They then continued on their journey to the next dungeon. Regarding Q's team, the two new guys were already chatting to him excessively. They filled Qiu in on a great deal about their captain. They also inquired as to Q's relationship with their commander, since the latter immediately granted him access to secret realms. Then he informed him that there was no relationship between the two of them. After that, they gave Qiu some background on their fabled commander. They informed him of Commander Ling's keen vision. He has a gift for seeing people's talents, and he may be able to see in the dark with this vision. Commander Liang has also attained professional level 8. Some people even assert that he is capable of reaching level 9. This man was also able to be on the front lines wearing a mask. At the time, their group was known as the Repelling Monsters Army, and he had to use a mask to battle that one. Qiu recalled the repulsive army of monsters. He wondered how much time had passed since then. On this particular mission, nobody acknowledged Q's leadership skills. He guided 3,000 experts to the front lines. They had also taken some territory back from the monsters for the first time. Back then, there were still an abundance of monsters in this place. They were in all places, and the repelling team succeeded in establishing their first base in these vast lands, despite losing countless lives in the process of fighting these monsters. Then, more bases were constructed in these regions, because they were led by a mask. Additionally, they were able to lessen the monster population. The frontliners were also born during this time. After some time, the group from Qiu had already reached the portal. It has been a while since they were allowed to enter a dungeon, so the two who accompanied him were now thrilled. Qiu shook his head, telling them he didn't need their assistance. Qiu wants to escape this dungeon by himself, just like Captain Jiang does. After entering, RMC was carried to this location. His nose was met with a potent monster odor. Finding out that there were many monsters in this hidden realm made him happy in a way, since he could kill every monster he saw and do anything he pleased with this. Then, these wolf-like creatures confronted Qiu. RMC approached them with courage. He told himself a little story. His body was still recovering, so he could only stay in monster form for 3 minutes at a time. but this was more than sufficient to get out of the dungeon. Qiu disappeared from these wolves' visions. They were already slashed off when they awoke the next morning. Qiu quickly eliminated four of them, and these wolves' bodies began to transform into energy. Afterward, Qiu absorbed these orbs. This was the great ghost's power, and he could use this powerful ability right now as well. Qiu could heal his body as long as he could absorb life forces. These two continued to wait outside the portal for Qiu in the interim. They even made a joke about finding Qiu's body lying around if they went inside. They didn't believe Qiu had the strength to open this forbidden area. Then the portal began to behave strangely. Our MC appeared. He was secure and unharmed. He was completely healed of all wounds. These two are in shock over what they just saw. Qiu managed to vanquish every monster in the realm, even the boss. He was unaware that there was a boss monster inside because these monsters were so weak. Qiu demonstrated to them the boss's dropped item. This will demonstrate to him that he successfully exited the dungeon. In just 17 minutes, RMC defeated a level 5 secret realm. He outran their captain in speed. The best clear time for Jiang was roughly half an hour. This demonstrated quite clearly how much more powerful Qiu was than Captain Jiang. Qiu then instructed them to proceed to the following secret realm. He breezed through the next one right away. Qiu continued to clear these realms until they ran out of time. Captain Jiang's team reached this portal much too late. They saw footprints, which indicated that someone had already exited the dungeon. Even before they arrived, the fourth or fifth dungeon had been cleared. The Qiu team was the only one to depart from the camp, and they believed that Qiu could not have finished so many dungeons in such a short amount of time. This guy was a little irritated that someone was pressuring them to finish these dungeons. "They're really not that bothersome," Captain Jiang informed them. She felt even more relieved that they had assistance from someone. However, the truth is that she was already curious about the identity of the professional who appeared to challenge her at Army Camp in 3. Each professional who cleared the dungeons was expected to turn in all of the items they had taken from it and submit a report. They will find it simpler to make these items into weapons if they do it this way. Professionals had the option to swap their merits for different inside the camp rewards. When Captain Jiang and her group returned, they saw the group that had cleared 17 secret realms in a single day. Since it was practically hard to demonstrate this accomplishment to the executive in charge, he was even debating whether or not this claim was true. All of the treasure rewards that Qiu's team received were distributed. Their bag was stuffed with materials and rare boss items. His shock was dashed by this. Even Captain Jiang couldn't have accomplished something this great so fast, so he can't just jump to this conclusion. This guy assured him that exploring these hidden worlds was simple. Even the Supreme Commander himself appointed him. This executive then informed Qiu that they wanted him to examine and clear the level 6 secret realm that is close to N1. In this domain, this camp has already lost two teams. The mission was quickly accepted by RMC. He then repeated his boast that Qiu would quickly escape this dungeon. Ultimately, he possessed greater power than Captain Jiang. The executive told him to look behind him as he was speaking. Right behind him was Captain Jiang, who didn't seem to be in the best of moods. Then, in a rush, he attempted to fabricate an alibi to please his captain. This guy additionally verified that, according to the list they had submitted, Qiu had cleared every dungeon they had visited. When Jiang asked Qiu if he completed this task by himself, RMCC replied in the affirmative. She gave him credit since he possesses the abilities to support his self-assurance in tackling these areas. She also asked the executive if she would be taking the level 6 secret realm mission, her competitive nature coming out. Qiu was formally challenged by Captain Jiang. The winner is the first person to kill the boss monster. Jiang's team then departed. This bald man complimented Qiu on his ability to bring out the competitive side of their captain. When RMCC looked over the specifics of the next realm he was going to clear, he realized why they were pushing him to lead this one. In addition, he recalled something from the past that would soon take place on the front lines. This guy saw something as he considered these particulars. He rose as he fixed his gaze on Q's face. They appear well known. This guy at last recalled where he had previously seen Qiu meanwhile. At Camp N3's command center, Commander Liang recently learned that the man who massacred the Kaijiang Investment Company was the same Xiao Qiu they had saved in the Hidden Realm. It was this blonde guy that reported it. They were somewhat perplexed since it is not feasible for someone to go from Da City to the front lines in a single day. However, this blonde man was positive about it. Every feature lined up. The sword of Qiu was the primary deal breaker. That type of sword could not be duplicated because they were too similar. They also considered the possibility that Qiu may have broken out of prison during the city's attack by the Great Ghost. He continued to think that he was correct even though the travel time was unachievable. Commander Liang then came to the conclusion that he would personally meet Qiu and conduct his own investigation after their mission tomorrow. Regarding this man, his motivation for reporting Qiu was to get promoted. Captain Jiang and her group were already in front of this portal the following day. These men were pleading with their captain to allow them to assist as well. This realm had already lost two teams, so she knew these guys were worried about her. She moved in the direction of the portal, but not before admonishing her team to make sure they could follow her. Our MC was incarcerated as well. Jiang warned him not to get involved in the other person's fight. This guy was the last to arrive because he was still awaiting the commander. Their team was taken to this tunnel of darkness via the portal. This man applied his ability. He stated that everything appeared to be normal. They are not facing any traps. They were walking when they began to feel the intense pressure. They ceased as a result. These lethal eyes began to appear at the other end of the tunnel. Now a swarm of crocodile monsters was moving in their direction. This was a level 6 secret realm's difficulty. Captain Jiang moved forward a step. She brandished her weapon and unleashed her bolt of lightning. Her bolt of lightning was simply too strong. It engulfed the entire tunnel, destroying every monster in its path. She destroyed all of them with a single blow. Her group began to applaud their captain. She told them, very humbly, that the only reason she was able to accomplish that was because every monster was arranged in a straight line. This bald guy teased and challenged our MC to give it his all with this. I'm still not sure how important this competition is. They then carried on walking in the direction of the tunnel. However, there was an oddity. Along the way, Captain Jiang hoped they would have seen the bodies of the teams that lost. The other guy made the suggestion that perhaps the bodies were caught in her previous attack and no evidence was left behind. They were deep in conversation when there was an interruption. Now, this guy was leaning against the wall, listening for something. The entire team was alerted when they heard a loud growl after that. The floor began to tremble as well. In front of them materialized a massive crocodile monster. This monster was large enough to use its body to block the entire passage. Captain Jiang felt a little let down by her team because they were so prone to fear. However, she also observed something else. Fear was coursing through the monster's entire body. These little pranks really aren't worth Captain Jiang's attention. She hurriedly threw her spear at the monster. Qiu, meanwhile, remained composed. He brandished his sword and prepared to launch another assault. But he had another target in mind. Our MC used Blood Raven to attack the ground. The massive crocodile gaped and was ready to strike Captain Jiang. But she struck it with a strong lightning strike. After overcoming the monster, Jiang then checked her team. Qiu's sword was on the ground when she saw him. His attack was so powerful that it split things open everywhere. Then our MC produced his weapon, and another crocodile that was moving underground was visible. Qiu used just one attack to defeat this monster as well. Because he is unable to absorb the life force of these monsters using his monster form, he also regrets entering this realm with this team. These guys, meanwhile, were taken aback. They were completely unaware that there was a monster beneath the surface. Captain Jiang then returned to her group and inquired of Qiu how he learned of the existence of the second monster. She was aware that her focus had been fixed on the monster in front of them, and her team would have been gone right now if it weren't for Qiu. Qiu informed her that the reason for this was the ground trembling. Furthermore, it's not unheard of for monsters to find a way below ground in these kinds of realms. This guy is still in shock. He can sense monsters thanks to his powers. He didn't feel the one on the ground when he used it. Qiu said nothing. He finds it difficult to explain why his senses were overly perceptive. He was even able to identify the demon gods that were tearing through space and time in his previous life. The two of them were commended by the team for defeating the dungeon's boss monster following this encounter. Captain Jiang later disclosed, though, that these monsters weren't even the boss ones. After they were vanquished, there isn't a treasure chest next to them, and the teleportation array wasn't there right now. The group now questions the nature of the boss's monster. Captain Jiang reminded her group to stay together and move quickly. These guys felt like they were not worth it in this mission, so they quickly apologized. But this was completely unimportant to her. They weren't at fault for this. They simply couldn't handle this realm. At the end of the tunnel, they then came across this enormous door. They recognized right away that this had to be the door leading to the boss monster. Captain Jiang was aware of the risk involved. This room will only be entered by her and Qiu. The remaining members of the team will remain behind to secure the entrance. Qiu and Jiang took hold of the knobs and rotated them. As soon as they were inside, they both went into the boss room. The door had been closed. These two kept strolling. Captain Jiang responded initially. She detected soft footsteps. This creature was the source of these. An apelid reptile. Jiang observed that it's once more a humanoid kind. She questioned why these kinds of monsters were so prevalent in most realms these days. At that point, the lizard got ready for combat. Jiang was aware that this monster had amassed a significant amount of power already. However, that didn't stop her from taking the initiative. She leaped towards the monster while wielding her weapon. Qiu did nothing but watch how she fought from a distance. Her spear was already traveling faster than sound. However, this monster managed to grasp her weapon. Captain Jiang was taken aback. This monster threw Jiang to the ground. Despite the clean heat, she recovered more quickly. Pointing her gun at the monster, she held it. This was a unique kind of gun that allowed her to use her lightning skill as its power source. The humanoid lizard was vanquished at that point. Although brief, this fight was intense. Qiu informed Zhang that her fighting style was too risky. However, this was simply her way of offering her all. It was impossible to expect the best outcome without putting their lives in danger for this mission. Something drew Jiang's attention during their conversation. She saw the bodies of the humanoid monster, and inside this one is a human body, and it was a man from one of the earlier raiding teams in this realm. She glanced over the corpse and pondered how he had become this. She realized then that there was a serious problem with the hidden worlds. Then more of the human-like lizards materialized in front of them. Our MC will handle the other side, while Jiang will handle the one on the left. The reptiles moved toward them. These two also ran over to them. Captain Zhang spearheaded the assault and leaped. Using her lightning skill, she charged her weapon and heated the ground. This was sufficient to cause the monsters to lose their equilibrium and expose themselves to her attacks. One humanoid lizard managed to dart and move unexpectedly. However, Zhang managed to stop it. She completed the task by spinning her spear. These monsters were out of the running. Considering that these were her old friends from the army camp, Captain Zhang was still able to recognize their advantages. These monsters are devoid of nothing but intelligence. She also looked up Q's status. This man was prospering. He's dispatching the monsters around him with ease. His every move was accurate. Eventually, there were just two humanoid lizards remaining. Captain Zhang also attested to the fact that every single one of these lizards was, in fact, the professional that vanished in this hidden domain. Q became aware of something. These enormous poles are behind the lizards. It began to respond, and the lizards likewise pivoted. These poles became idolized by these monsters. Captain Zhang believed that these creatures were attempting to call forth an entity. It released a foreboding aura around it. Additionally, a face materialized in front of them. When Zhang saw this face, she nearly passed out from sheer terror. She was aware that she couldn't allow these monsters to call this creature. She launched her spear in the direction of the monsters, and it struck some of them. These red eyes then started to fade. In the process, the altar vanished as well. Zhang questioned Qiu right away about what had transpired. Knowing that those eyes belonged to a demon god who exists in nothingness, Qiu knew, and it is gazing upon him. Our MC knew the identity of this demon god. Following that fierce battle, Captain Zhang's group was able to successfully exit the hidden world. They exited the portal as well. Her group began to applaud and celebrate these two. However, Zhang appeared more worried about what was going on inside. She isn't even overjoyed about it. This got the four of them to reflect. However, someone spoke and they became aware of it. It was the head of state. This man traveled with an army of men. A law enforcement team was brought in by their boss, which confused a few of the guys. Then he assured them not to worry, that this is not at all about them. This issue had to do with RMC. At last, Commander Linzig has disclosed Q's real identity. That was the same man who had broken the law in the city. Everyone was shocked, with the exception of the blonde guy. That's when things began to make sense. They began to recognize Q's face from the television. This man took great pride in his discoveries. He alerted his colleagues to the Q. However, our MC was not going to conceal this information. He made his introductions to everyone once more. Yes, in the city he was the same man. Q's admission of this fact made the blonde guy happy. Q then inquired as to whether the commander would return him to Star City. All criminals should be sent to the atonement camp in accordance with the laws of their government. However, this man had other ideas. He informed everyone that the rule is no longer in effect in this army camp. These soldiers were perplexed by this statement. The commander then informed Q that he had already considered his offense and that he would have taken the same action if he had been in his shoes. Our MC was even commended by Commander Ling for his actions. Following that altercation, he gave the order for everyone to keep this information private, and that person will be compelled to leave the army camp if they spread these rumors about Q once more. Everyone in the prison appeared to be aware of the circumstances. Regarding Captain Zhang, she desired a private conversation with her commander. The others felt uneasy about this move. They were positive it had to do with what their captain and Q had found in the hidden world. Everything was reported by Captain Zhang. She then inquired of her mentor whether he had any knowledge of those monsters and the reason behind their worship of an object inside the realm. Commander Liang informed her that it was a monster god since he was aware of it. The idea that monsters have gods startled her. Then he revealed to her that numerous experts had made every effort to eradicate all of the world's hidden domains, though it may have always eluded him. This occurred as a result of their failure to destroy the monster's origin. As long as the monster gods are imprisoned, new realms will continue to appear even after they have cleared everyone in this world. She went on to ask him how to defeat these monster gods and where to find them. The one she saw inside the realm was one of the monster gods. These gods possess too much power. They are far more powerful than the monsters at the calamity level. They occupied the highest position in the food chain. Jian discovered that even a small portion of these gods' power could wipe out humankind. Commander Ling informed her that humanity had made every effort to repel these deities. They were even surpassed by someone who killed one or two of them, and Mask was the only one who was able to accomplish that. He continued by saying that the monsters would soon begin rioting because an altar had been discovered, and if they are not dealt with, there will eventually be a sea of monsters in this area. Altars appearing indicates that the monster gods were in motion. This place will be inundated with thousands of monsters if the phenomenon known as the Sea of Monsters materializes, and every army camp in the huge area will vanish into thin air. Jian thought back to the moments when the mask was still present. She believed they would be able to defeat it, but it's not possible anymore. Commander Ling then issued a warning, stating that the secret realms should not be approached as they were still unstable. Additionally, he gave Captain Jian some downtime because ever since she arrived here, she had behaved like a robot, attacking monsters. When she delivers the information to the other camps, he also instructed her to bring Qiu. His final request was for Jian to get a mask so that he could conceal his identity from RMCC. If others knew his secret, they might not feel comfortable around him. We'll get to see Xiao Qiu don a mask once more. Following that incident, Captain Jiang's team was assigned the duty of delivering something to the other camps. This armored train now contained them. They were all sitting around indoors. The bald man asked Qiu how his first train ride was, along with RMC who was wearing a mask. He exalted himself, saying this car was the most dependable means of transportation in the desert. He was reprimanded by the others for persistently sharing this information with every newcomer they connected with. They will soon arrive at M2, another army camp. These men were tasked with conveying crucial information. The train felt a big bump just as they were trying to get some sleep. They noticed a second car next to them when they peered outside. Captain Jiang's group responded right away and got ready for the worst. They reasoned that this team might be from M2, and that they were attempting to escape the monsters that had broken out of the portal. Certain hidden zones have a time constraint. If the experts don't finish clearing it in time, monsters will begin to emerge. These guys continued to make every effort to escape with their lives. One of them attempted to eliminate the monsters from behind as well. These wolves were pursuing them. Monsters were flooding this realm. Even though one of the team's professionals killed more than 30 of them, they were still outnumbered. He also realized that he had used up all of his arrows. A bullet killed the wolf that attempted to leap in the direction of their car. Then these guys noticed the train with armor next to them. The train's inbuilt machine gun was aimed at something. It heats their car's tires on purpose. This resulted in the truck colliding, but this bird monster was already perched above them. They were spared from becoming the monster's target by this crash. The monster is then heated by the armored train. Now the experts were secure. Following that incident, the armored train kept moving in their direction. The team of Captain Jiang and Qiu were also moving in the direction of the monsters. This guy was rendered speechless after alerting them to the beast's numbers. Captain Jiang and Qiu quickly killed the majority of the wolves. The others offered assistance. Their collaboration was flawless. These guys were simply too strong. They took care of this in a matter of seconds. This guy picked up on Qiu's and Jiang's strengths right away. Captain Jiang instructed her team to tend to the survivors and get them onto the train after battling these monsters. The materials from these monsters will also be harvested by the others. Then the N3 team was thanked for their assistance by the professionals on the opposing team. Because of their captain, these guys were already aware that they were from N3. Even in these areas, they had heard about her, as she was quite well-liked. Qiu was an individual they were unfamiliar with. Then Qiu was presented to them by the bald man. He disclosed to the opposing team that Qiu was recently assigned. These guys were originally 15, but only 3 of them survived, according to Captain Jiang's team. This resulted from the unexpected rise in monster population within the hidden domains. The seals on a few of the nearby secret realms were also broken. It is the reason they were outnumbered. Although they had anticipated that some realms would have weak seals, they were all broken at once. Jiang surmised that this might be a portent of the approaching sea of monsters. She then made the hasty decision to head to M20 camp first. These two were scouting the area surrounding the base at the M20 army camp in the meantime. One of them saw that many of their camp's teams were leaving to clear the realms, but that none of them had come back yet. Then this guy suggested that perhaps they were simply taking their time to clean up the hidden realms. This one noticed something when he was surveying the area. A train with armor was approaching them. One of them waved a red flag to indicate that the train should slow down so they could inspect it, but the train disregarded the order. The train entered right away. It slammed into the army camp's walls. The soldiers all went to see what had happened right away. Something emerged as the train's door opened. It's a professional's body. Next, the soldiers encountered the offender. What they were witnessing was unbelievable to them. There was a humanoid insect in front of them. These monsters began to emerge from the train as more doors opened. They attacked, looking like enormous locusts. Since this was an unexpected attack, They had limited time to respond appropriately, and the M12O army camp was already in disarray shortly after. An army of insects was led by this monster to destroy this base. This type of monster was novel. One of the experts at Captain Jiang's armored train in the meantime reported that M12O was under attack from monsters. These beasts easily defeated a level 7 professional in that base. Monsters had never before ventured to attack a human base. Something isn't right. If the level 7 commander perished in that attack, Captain Jiang was not overly shocked. She believed that this was a creature from the sea of monsters they had anticipated. However, she was still taken aback upon witnessing the condition of the M20 camp. It had already started to burn completely. Then, a radio report was forwarded to every base in the vicinity. It stated that monsters were attacking the M20 camp. Backups were requested by the surviving individuals. Additionally, it stated that their commander had died quickly. The army camp at M20 will also collapse. They could all see the extensive damage as they got closer to the base. The M20 camp was destroyed by the monster's attack. Captain Jiang speculated that they ought to be getting ready for this sea of monsters. She then gave the order for everyone to continue advancing toward the M20 camp. The bald man alerted his captain to the potential monsters within. She does not, however, plan to battle the monsters. Her only goal was to find and rescue the survivors of the assault. This soldier was becoming enraged. He recalled the moments when the mask was still in place. Things of this nature did not occur. Now he's placing the blame on those who banished the greatest hero. The monsters seemed to be aware that the mask was missing. They all fell silent after realizing that. The bald man then attempted to interrupt this and lighten the atmosphere. He informed them that, if they look closely, Qiu appears to be the greatest hero because he is now sporting a mask. The others concurred right away. Even from his stance, this man appeared to be wearing a mask. Then he came up to Qiu and asked him in jest if he was wearing a mask. Our MC provided an honest response to the question because he lacks a sense of humor. He revealed to them that he is a mask. They all fell silent at his solemn expression. At that point, they assumed Qiu was being humorous. A few of them even requested autographs. Captain Jiang joined in as well. She expressed to Qiu her hope that this man would truly live up to the reputation of her idol. The entire M2 camp was still on fire in the interim. These creatures continued to prowl and watch over the area. From a distance, Captain Jiang could see these monsters, and she questioned whether they were actually the ones that caused M2 to fall. And after that she noticed some people fleeing from a swarm of monsters. The only ones who escaped the attack were these guys. Outside, they were met by Captain Jiang's team. They also made sure that no monsters could approach these escaping survivors and offered some assistance. This woman also brandished her weapon once more and encircled it with her lightning-wielding ability. She took a position and hurled the weapon as hard as she could. All of the approaching insect monsters were heated by this. The extra lightning skill had an effect as well. The spear detonated in midair, taking out every monster pursuing the survivors. Many of them burned to death. When the monsters realized this, they began to retreat. These survivors were approached by Captain Jiang, who inquired about the state of the camp. That the M2 camp had collapsed, this guy informed her, and advised them not to approach the camp because their commander had perished in a battle with these insects. He informed them that one monster was in charge of its entire kind. It's a humanoid insect, just like the others. It was also too strong, taking only 30 seconds to take down their commander. The survivors urged them to stay away from the camp. However, Captain Jiang had remained quiet the entire time. Then she took an unexpected action. All were shocked by this. Captain Jiang then disclosed to them that the men in front of them were not the actual M2 camp soldiers. They are the prisoners from the Camp of Atonement. These guys weren't expecting her to say these things to them. The other guys on her team didn't give a damn because they needed all the assistance they could get at the moment. The survivors refuted these claims as well. The issue, though, was that these guys had murdered the experts who were accompanying them as they ran from the monsters. Their entire equipment set is mismatched, even with their arms. Nor was the injury on his left ear caused by the monsters. When their secret was revealed, these guys looked at each other. They made a mad dash for Captain Jiang. However, she was ready already. She struck these two prisoners with her weapon. Regarding the other, it attempted to flee. He also considered using the civilians as a means of escape from this predicament. But something threw off his perception. Already a sword has claimed him. The Blood Raven was this sword. Qiu was the source. This guy from the M2 camp further attested to the fact that none of these three were known to him. And now that it's all gone, they won't be attending M2 camp. Additionally, this man went up to his captain and informed her of their current issue. A while back, the train's broiler failed while they were moving at top speed. Then somebody held up a hand. She mentioned that she could go check if it was a mechanical issue. The broiler eventually started operating once more. This woman quickly fixed it. Even though she was still a student, her abilities were already comparable to those of an experienced mechanic. Captain Jiang inquired as to her name. This woman identified herself as Evelyn Clark, and her goal is to become the greatest mechanic of all time. Evelyn assisted in getting the train back on track. Their group also began strategizing for their next move. They were going to move toward the L4 and Y5 of the army camp, but they are unable to go to M2. It will only take them 2 days to get to Camp L4, which is much closer than the other one. The issue, though, is that they had to cross the M2 and it was simply too dangerous. So even though it will take them 5 days, everyone agreed that they should just go to Y5. Evelyn and Q insisted that they should simply go in the direction of L4. The mechanic also brought up the concern of wanting 5 days' worth of fuel. They will now proceed to L4, as running out of fuel in the middle of the desert was not an option. RMC was still lounging in the shadows. Someone then questioned him about why he was so adamant about going toward L4. Captain Jiang was this one. She doesn't think Q just so happened to be aware of their fuel predicament. Q recalled a memory from his previous persona. This scene was also present in the Y5 camp, which was the first to collapse. He was aware that by now this base was populated entirely with monsters. He then made the decision to not respond to her. Captain Jiang then posed a further query to Q. It had to do with her dad. She inquired about her father's character since he was the one who placed Q under arrest. All that Q could tell her was that her father was a good man. Although this response was excessively ambiguous, Captain Jiang found it sufficient. The M2 camp was still blazing to the ground in the meantime. This humanoid bug was terrifying as well. It even had a newspaper in its grasp. This monster, too, was able to speak, and it rose to its feet. He noticed a train passing directly in front of their camp. This monster was aware that humans were present within the train. Then he opened its wings and took off straight for the train. The other insects in the camp began to drop their lead as well. The train's soldiers were attempting to quiet the passengers. They assured them that there were plenty of experienced professionals on this train who could easily keep them safe. The man informed everyone that the smoke from the M2 base was still growing after taking a look outside. However, he was informed by a civilian that it was not smoke. The one they could see ahead of them was a swarm of monsters. And this humanoid creature was one of these monsters. The captain realized they were in serious trouble right away. The M2 base camp commander was killed by this humanoid insect, and she's unsure of her ability to control such a monster. Captain Jiang was also seen by the humanoid insect. This monster was aware that it needed to eliminate these people immediately. Then it reached out and grabbed one of the flying insect's legs. It sets itself up to appear as though he is also locked onto something. The leg that the monster hurled in the direction of the train struck the wheels. As soon as possible, the train lost balance and began to crash. Evelyn was among the civilians who were thrown outside the train. Fortunately, someone moved quickly enough to save them. Captain Jiang and Question were the first to respond. Following Evelyn's rescue, these two moved on to their next assignment, as well as to stop the train from collapsing. To save the train, these two pushed it with everything they had. And with that, the train had returned to its original location. Evelyn was shocked by what transpired. That was how a 10,000-ton train was pushed by two experts. Everyone on board the train was safe as well. Everyone was also given the order to defend the train at all costs by Captain Jiang. Evelyn was also given the order to begin inspecting the train for damage and to get repairs done as soon as feasible. Captain Jiang realized that the lives of some civilians were no longer as important as the train. Their only means of escaping the swarms of monsters in front of them was via this train. Then, she employed the same move that had previously vanquished numerous monsters. It was an attack in which she transferred her lightning skill in midair using her weapon as a conduit. Captain Jiang began to kill these creatures. The fact that this woman was only a level 6 professional astounds the soldiers from the N2 camp. They were aware that Captain Jiang possessed even greater strength than their N2 camp commander. The other guys began assisting her in lowering the monster count as well. This one, meanwhile, was merely observing their struggle. This monster was pointed out by a bystander. The commander was killed by that person. Captain Jiang was startled to feel pressure from this insect that resembled a human. She leaped and was on her way to giving the monster a hit. However, the monster appeared to vanish as soon as she let go of her attack. She was aware that the person she struck was merely an afterimage. This monster moved at an extremely high speed. Captain Jiang was then attacked by the monster. She was knocked to the ground by the powerful attack. The humanoid insect was about to launch another attack because it didn't want to stop there. It was about to use its sideways turned arms to attack Captain Jiang. Fortunately, though, she made a full recovery and stopped the attack. She was in danger only a few centimeters away. Then someone arrived to assist promptly. That was RMCC. He struck the creature with a heat. It shot him into the air and toward the forest. Captain Jiang didn't anticipate Q assisting her. He then gave her an order to take care of the leftovers and informed her that he would now take the humanoid insect on his own. Captain Jiang lacked the strength necessary to stop Q. She merely instructed him to live. This insect, humanoid, was still in the air. It was struck by a blow that was too strong. It eventually managed to reclaim itself. Qiu was moving toward the insect that resembled a human. Because Qiu had the same scent as theirs but was disguised as a human, the monster became perplexed. However, RMC wasn't really bothered by these issues. He threw his mask back and told the insect that looked like a human that he was neither a monster nor a human. In addition, he regained control of the blood raven, gradually gathered his strength, and prepared to change. He preferred to be referred to as a monster after transforming. To the blood raven, he spoke. They were both relieved that they could now attack this humanoid insect with all of their might. This monster felt uneasy all over its body upon witnessing Q's new form. Since it is the only one with a chance, it knew it should launch its attack first. And it accomplished that. He sprinted over to Qiu. His blow struck Qiu directly. The force of the impact was so great that it cracked everything. It resembled a massive explosion. Qiu was still standing up when the dust had settled, though. RMC was a little let down. Is that the only power this humanoid insect possesses? He asked. This monster felt a chill go down its spine upon hearing these words. He then decided to launch another round of vicious attacks on Qiu. This continued for some time. But Qiu had enough and reached a conclusion. He informed the humanoid bug that he was now in the lead. This monster lacks emotions even though it already possesses some intelligence. But fear struck him the moment he saw Qiu with his blood raven. This humanoid monster that destroyed an entire army base was vanquished with a single blow. The new form that RMC was in was simply too strong. And as long as he takes down more monsters, it will continue to rise to greater heights. He was also informed by the system that the monster selected by the gods had been vanquished. This monster was sent by a demon god known as Treacherous Wisdom. Blood Raven began consuming this monster's blood as well, and it gave the sword its second evolution, as it was the blood of a demon god. Blood Raven was changing once more. Crow Tide is a new ability this ancient blade has. This enables it to change into a sea of crows that will eat its adversaries whole. Qiu was happy that his weapon had gained strength once more. In the meantime, the captain and her group had defeated every monster in the region. Now, Qiu was a concern for them. They believed that he had already given his life in order to save them. Captain Giant was unable to speak. She was opposed to Q's demise. However, as soon as someone informed them that Qiu had returned, they all looked away. This guy had his mask put back on, and his body was free of any scratches. Qiu replied in the affirmative when the bald man asked if he had truly vanquished the monster. But because that monster destroyed an entire army base, this guy finds it hard to believe. Their train was moving again after that. Then, as they traveled, the laypeople attended to the professional's wounds. Qiu was also thanked by Captain Giant for saving her life. She informed Qiu that he was rapidly gaining more power. It resembled the one that Mask possessed. As they battled monster after monster, their powers continued to expand. Evelyn then cut them off and delivered the unfavorable news. They were using a radio, but it wasn't working. Not even the closest army camp can be reached by them. She even has a theory regarding this issue. Evelyn reported that their signal seemed to be blocked by someone. Not only are they unable to send signals, they are also unable to receive any. They appeared to be cut off from the outside world. The system then sent a fresh notification to RMC. It is a fresh task, and eliminating the sea of monsters that was going to attack every army camp was the primary goal. Qiu will experience an evolution that might make him a demon god as payment for his efforts. This prize caught the attention of RMC. The train continued to travel in the direction of the L4 army camp after that. But then, out of nowhere, a message was heard on their radio. It originated at the L4 army camp. Evelyn was taken aback by the fact that yesterday there were no radio signals. She then responded to the radio, informing the L4 army camp of their predicament, and that they were moving in their direction. The 4th army camp reacted. They were already aware that the M2 had already dropped. To get some protection, they gave the train the order to arrive at the army camp as soon as possible. Evelyn was more relieved because they were running low on fuel as well. They must go to L4 immediately. Both civilians and professionals were relieved to be able to rest and begin their new lives in this army camp. However, a second radio signal was picked up. They were informed by the voice on the other end not to put their trust in L4. The message said that the monsters were the ones who had contacted them, and that level 4 had already fallen. Everyone was shocked by this development. Nowadays, monsters are not only intelligent, they can also mimic human speech. Captain Zhang then recalled the times the monsters had behaved humanoid. The humanoid insects from a while back and the humanoid lizards from earlier were concrete evidence that they could actually accomplish this. Then she reached for the radio and asked who was talking on the other end. Then the person on the radio disclosed that they were alive. It was them who fought off the monsters 2 days prior and were able to escape. L4 had already been demolished. He also informed them that all of the monsters that assaulted level 4 were strong and strange. They even easily defeated a professional at level 8. In addition, he provided them with the coordinates of the makeshift camp that they had already established. However, a second signal then passed over the first. One of them, according to L4 in the makeshift camp, was the monsters posing as people. This perplexed everybody. It is impossible for them to determine who was telling the truth. A few civilians chose to believe the people from the L4 camp because they understood that an army base would be difficult to take down in the face of the monsters. Captain Jian was still considering his options. Then she inquired about Q's viewpoint. Our MC advised them not to visit either location. He informed them that these two camps were set up as traps. He once lived as a demon god who had the power to teach and counsel other monsters. The name of this demonic god was Treacherous Wisdom. The camp's collapse was also caused by this demonic deity. The monsters who had been given intelligence went on the rampage. They tricked and enslaved people as well. However, the last time, the L4 camp managed to withstand the monsters' attacks. Our MC believed that they had more energy to spare since he was not going to the void and was instead fighting these demon gods. For this reason, the attack was sufficient to bring down L4. Q was now considering whether this development was ultimately beneficial or detrimental. Then he grinned and realized that everything would be alright as long as the world didn't end. The extinction of humanity was the only thing that Q was concerned with stopping. Following that perplexing encounter with the monsters posing as people, Captain Giant's group made the decision to simply visit and inspect the makeshift camp. When they arrived at the location shown by the coordinates, they discovered a tiny campsite that had been erected by people. They were immediately welcomed by these L4 professionals. However, the only issue was that monsters already had control over them. They launched an attack on Captain Jian's group shortly after. The person who stopped these men from attacking their group was RMC. Despite their speedy resolution of the issue, they sustained some losses. Evelyn was assigned the duty of exchanging some supplies to this camp with a few soldiers, but her friends were subsequently killed. The only person to survive is her. Captain Jian was taking notes on all of this. This diary was with her. Q was then approached by Captain Jian. She informed Q that the L4 army camp was also tricked into capturing these survivors, which ultimately resulted in their base being captured by the monsters. She questioned whether it was truly possible for monsters to develop intelligence and even the capacity to devise their own plans of action. Q was aware that this could happen. Traitorous Wisdom, in contrast to the other demon gods, always employs his cunning against mask. While he is hiding and plotting something more dangerous, he lets everyone carry out their duties. Traitorous Wisdom was the only demon god he had not yet encountered. This one always runs away from conflict. Additionally, Jian unlocked the weapon that Q wields. She informed him that it was very potent. Then he revealed to her that it was a friend's gift. After murdering her younger sister, Q wondered if Zixi would still regard him as a friend. He had gone through the same thing in a previous life, and it did not end well. However, he is aware that these things cannot truly divert him at this time. This guy interrupted their conversation by telling Captain Jian to look outside. Something was taking place over on this cliff. Numerous monsters were sprinting in the same direction. Even these ones that flew existed. Captain Jian saw these monsters were also en route to the A1 army camp very quickly. They numbered in the thousands at the very least. Then, this guy noticed something across the battlefield. Numerous tanks were set to confront these monstrosities. When these people began to attack, the monsters were hit. Many of them were vanquished. Captain Jian commended these guys for their military strategies, saying they managed to gather all the monsters in one location and eliminate them all at once. The train kept moving toward the A1 army camp. These trucks also made their way toward them. The train was stopped by Captain Jian and her crew. They also gave these soldiers from A1 an introduction. However, weapons were aimed at them rather than being welcomed. These A1 guys don't have faith in them. The bald man made an effort to clarify and dispel this misconception. However, these guys informed them that the initial victims of the monster's control had also expressed the same sentiments. Then someone spoke from behind them. He said he knew these people to the A1 soldiers. This man has been the supreme commander of Ling ever since the intelligent monster attack. When accepting survivors from the other camps, A1 army camp had been cautious and cautious. They even constructed a quarantine facility to ensure that the humans they were assisting were not under the influence of supernatural beings. Commander Ling gave them an explanation of everything, including the reasons for following these procedures initially. He also informed Captain Jian that they were able to flee in A1 before the sea of monsters could reach in 3 camp. Everyone present was secure. The fact that camps were being abandoned in this manner, despite the fact that significant resources had been expended in their construction, gave her cause for concern. She was also informed by Commander Ling about the traitors who attempted to trick the A1 camp. Being detained in this room to prove her worth to them didn't bother Captain Jian. Next, she inquired about the intelligent monsters from her mentor. She was aware that if not for these particular ones, humans could easily repel these monsters. These ones, Commander Ling informed her, were connected to the monster gods. He only knows this, however, she may soon find out more. He also informed her that because they were short on personnel, the higher-ups would assign her to a new mission as soon as she was cleared. She began considering how she could learn more about these monster gods as soon as Commander Ling departed. She looked at something as she rotated her head. Qiu was in her cell with her, and this guy was working on something. He was studying the military atlases for this area. Qiu was observing the dormant volcano close to the A1 camp. While they were being quarantined, the news about these congressmen was broadcast on television, and he was planning to stop the Sea of Monsters. They reportedly informed everyone that additional reinforcements had already been sent to assist in defending the front lines against the Sea of Monsters. These guys continued to worry about how the public would perceive them despite the intense battle. Even though Captain Jian was enraged with these men, she was aware of their considerable power. The weakest of these men was ranked at level 8, and they could have used some assistance from them. After some time, these guards informed Captain Jian and Captain Qiu that they had both been released from quarantine and that they would soon be granted the power to command an entire squadron. They also gave them their weapons back. Captain Jian speculated that perhaps more force was required to guide the populace against these monsters, which is why things may have gotten worse. Evelyn was specifically asked to join Q's squad. The squad that they were going to command was then presented to these two. They discovered that they were going to take charge of a group of inmates from the camp for redemption. They even brought these prisoners up to assist, since they needed all the manpower they could get. Captain Jian was aware of these guys' malice. They were more difficult to lead and their fighting abilities were mediocre at best. After that, the officers gave them some radio equipment so that even with so many prisoners under their care, Qiu and Jian could still talk to each other. Qiu was grateful for the gesture. He was aware that his plan would require something similar. The officer added that since the northwest portion of the battlefield is the riskiest, Qiu and Jian's team should remove their group from there. However, our MC had a different idea in mind. He made the deliberate decision to be in the northwest. This officer became perplexed. Then he reiterated to Qiu that location was the most hazardous area of the battlefield. Qiu assured him that he was competent. And in return for selecting the area that was the most dangerous, he requested 20 military maps of the region, several small nuclear bombs, and some trip wires. Despite not knowing what was going on, Captain Jian supported Q's choice. Although the officer was still unsure about their decision, he nevertheless gave it to them. Additionally, he ensured that Qiu would receive everything he asked for. Jian then deduced Q's strategy. Qiu picked the most dangerous prisoner to intimidate the others and force them to obey him because they were in charge of these prisoners. However, she informed Qiu that this plan was simply too dangerous as these men could still defy their orders, potentially leading to their extinction. He went on to inform Jian that the effectiveness of this plan hinged on how well she and Evelyn could carry out their assigned tasks. Evelyn was now experiencing panic due to the task assigned to her 2 hours later. She is unsure if the individuals accompanying them will cooperate, in addition to the fact that they were close to a volcano. All of the individuals were criminals. They really had to give it a shot, Qiu informed her. These tiny nuclear weapons were being placed throughout the region. Qiu provided the precise location for each prisoner to place these devices. Here, there were a few men who were really uncooperative. Ultimately, they have just encountered Qiu, and they must now obey his orders. Qiu approached the inmates after realizing this. One of them took this action out of annoyance. He warned Qiu to behave, saying that if they could also find Captain Jian and Evelyn, his life would be spared. Captain Jian became agitated at this statement. She bolted in the direction of this man, using her lightning speed. And he was in excruciating pain the moment he realized it. Captain Jian had already grabbed him with her weapon. Qiu didn't object to this at all. For these criminals to understand that she was more than enough to kill them all, they needed this. Captain Jian also demonstrated her lethal lightning abilities to them. This was sufficient to inform them of the mission's leader. Qiu offered these offenders two choices. Either you die or you obey his commands. There are monsters everywhere, so they are unable to leave this area either. The artillery battle with the monsters also intensified. Qiu and the others turned to face the fighting, seeing the monsters moving forward more slowly. Evelyn was aware that the monsters could quickly encircle them if these lines of defense were breached. The inmates began to lose it as well. It was the moment that Qiu had been anticipating. Now that they were in a desperate situation, these men would do anything he said. Additionally, our MC assured them that he would work a miracle if they would just do as he said. They were stunned by this statement. Qiu then allocated each person. 10 people will make up each group. Each group will also receive a radio. The radio was the most crucial item, and they must prevent the monsters from obtaining any of them. From group to group K, the groups were given names, and there is a designated spot for each of them to place the devices. Evelyn also discovered a way to put these tiny devices everywhere. Some of the groups have already attained their positions shortly after. They also mentioned that monsters were now encircling them. They were instructed to back up and take the route he pointed out. Even though these inmates continued to have doubts about his abilities, they were forced to follow him. And they actually encountered the monsters as they raced in the direction that Qiu had indicated. Qiu then gave them the order to attack these monsters with everything they had. These guys withdrew after diverting the monsters' attention. Qiu teased these monsters on purpose. He desired their agitation. In a few seconds, the next set of devices will go off. Then there was a loud explosion that could be heard everywhere. The explosion caught the irate monsters off guard. The escaping convicts were then collected together in one location by Qiu. Monsters were coming at these guys from all sides now, and these inmates came to understand the precise plan that Qiu carried out one by one. With Q's instructions, they were now confident that they would all make it out alive. The monsters threw all of their weapons at each other as soon as they formed a group, and it defeated every monster nearby. Their goal was accomplished. Following their assignments, each group was instructed to head back to the summit of the mountain. In addition, Qiu had to use her abilities to set off each of the tiny nuclear bombs hidden throughout the hot springs. That was activated, and the weapons burst, spewing out a terrifying amount of water. The massive rocks and trees on the mountain behind the landslide that resulted from these. The monsters that were hiding around the mountain were quickly engulfed by the waters. All of the monsters were destroyed by this last move. This development shocked all of the generals present at headquarters. A group of outlaws from the Redemption Camp emerged victorious from the sea of monsters. However, as is customary, Song Ming, He Yao, and other congressmen who made no contributions at all received the credit. Song Ming gave the inmates a kind gift in exchange. After gathering them, he flew them in a private jet. They discovered that they would simply be sent back to prison just when they felt that their efforts had been valued. Evelyn, Captain Jiang's team, and Qiu were promptly allocated to their next location. A few days later, the criminals discovered that these congressmen had taken all of their glory and they began to riot inside their cells. The authorities then made the decision to arrest each of these men and accuse them of being violent. Meanwhile, the commander-in-chief of One were having a conversation about the prisoners at the chief's house with Song Ming. "Why did the chief allow them to kill all the prisoners?" this guy asked. He then explained to Song Ming that he took that action to preserve their reputation. These detainees might disseminate some tales regarding the actual events of their conflict with the Sea of Monsters. Additionally, the chief designated a few individuals to keep an eye on Qiu and the others in case they discussed the actual events. In addition, Song Ming ensured that such incidents would not recur in the future. The chief disclosed information regarding the weapons they anticipated assisting the front lines as well. The chief was reassured by Song Ming that these weapons were en route to the front lines. These soldiers continued to hold their defense against the monsters during their meeting. This was the line of defense the chief was referring to. An increasing number of vicious monsters were emerging and proliferating to breach their defenses. However, their officer then advised them to withdraw to the second line of defense. The soldiers were perplexed by this because they would have to forfeit all of their sacrifices if they gave up this position. However, the officer claimed that they were merely carrying out higher-ups' orders. From behind came the voice telling them to get lost. It came from these enormous, strong men. These individuals were the weapons that Song Ming had mentioned. Soldiers with altered genetics. This soldier was informed by the scientist behind him that all tests had been completed and that he could now launch an attack. These guys requested that the regular soldiers relocate. Then he struck his chest with his fist. Something was triggered by this action. At that point, the serum on their back began to enter their bodies. This caused all of their nerves and muscles to enlarge. Their hearts had to beat far more quickly as well. These soldiers' bodies were buffed up once more. Then these guys charged into battle. They were going to square off against monsters. The initial results of their experiments satisfied the scientists who conducted them. They treated these humans like monsters, and they were quite proud of it. These soldiers, meanwhile, were amazed. They believed that Star City's soldiers possessed excessive strength. All the monsters in their path were eliminated with a single blow. They found the battle to be too simple. They felt free to charge right in the middle of the monsters since they couldn't be content with these meek creatures. Now, the soldiers behind the lines were beginning to worry about them. He was then informed that doing so was the only way for these soldiers to reveal their true abilities. They were expected to fight these kinds of battles. Monsters were now encircling this one. He also showed off his changed face when he took off his helmet. Now this soldier resembled a monster. This was the Morning Sun project that Hyo had previously mentioned. This one was eager to reveal his actual self because he was away from the crowd and no one could see his face at the moment. Once more, he started an injection. This exerted extreme pressure on his body. His body was about to tense up against his bodysuit. His hands began to change too. Then, using just his hand, he grabbed one of the monsters and squeezed it. This guy was going to wipe out every monster in this place. The tide reversed in a matter of seconds. The human soldiers were now the ones pursuing the monsters. This guy finds it hard to comprehend that this time it was the monsters that were running for their lives. Meanwhile, the scientists noted that the advancements they have made today far surpassed their initial expectations. It only took 100 changed soldiers to send the monsters fleeing for their lives, and he is certain that they could produce the most potent professionals if they could enhance these outcomes in the future. Some of them even carried some of the monsters' body parts with them. They desired to use these monsters in the upcoming series of experiments. These soldiers wanted to go to the next defensive position as well. They still had a bloodless that would not go away. Before they could fight again, the scientists advised them to get checked out. However, the ground began to tremble. Then, what they saw astounded them. Behind them is this monster that resembles a titan. Its steps and motions were sufficient to cause the ground to tremble. They were unsure of the monster's origins at this point, but the changed soldier sensed that it originated from every monster's corpse that had been vanquished. This one, who had been hoping to take on more formidable opponents, could care less. He launched himself at the creature. He cut through the monster with his sword, but nothing took place. He was also captured by the monster. The monster's reflexes were rapidly observed by the scientists, who concluded that they were easily level 9 monsters. The modified soldier was also cautioned by the scientists not to use any fluid and to change positions directly in front of large crowds. However, they were not using their reason correctly because they were unable to control their bloodlust. For as long as possible, that was all they wanted to do. Once more, the soldier injected fluids into his body, causing a transformation that was strong enough to tear off his bodysuit. It also showed his ultimate form. His entire appearance resembled that of the monsters. Some soldiers believed that this one had become a monster. Then, the changed soldier mustered all his strength to break free from this monster's hold. He battled and persisted in trying, but to no avail. This monster's fingers haven't even moved. The titan simply gazed at him. It lifted its other hand after that. And finally, the titan used its hands to squeeze the changed soldier. Honestly, there wasn't much he could do about this. The researchers then ascertained what had occurred. With purpose, the monster teased its victim. The reports about these level 9 monsters were then given to the chief, but the line was cut off before anyone could answer his query. He saw these titans approaching the A1 army camp as soon as he dashed to his balcony to assess the situation. This story quickly became attack on titan. Songming was promptly informed of this by the chief. The higher authorities were all aware that the monster gods were the only reason these kinds of occurrences were taking place. And since the mask was gone, they made their move. The chief didn't intend to reveal the mask's name to Song Ming. However, this guy stood by what he said. The lack of the mask was causing these things to occur, and Song Ming once more put the blame for this catastrophe on Mask. He had the power to change things with a simple word. As of right now, the camp consisted of 40 level 7 professionals, 15 level 8 professionals, and 6 level 9 professionals. Song Ming and the chief are included in this. To be a canon father, Song Ming informed the chief that they could use every professional rank between 7 and 8. As for him, he's just a representative from Star City, so he wouldn't be helping to defend this base. It disgusted the chief to hear this statement. Song Ming intends to carry out their actions in the city as well. They intend to use the soldiers as a means of buying some time before attacking the monsters with nuclear weapons. Whether or not he has to sacrifice some of the experts in the process is irrelevant to him. This guy has it all planned out. Their modified soldiers, supported by science, will replace the lower-level professionals. The chief was aware that Song Ming could fulfill all of his desires, and for that reason, in order to avoid trouble, he will also follow this man's plan. He then accepted all of his terms and promised to immediately make the arrangements, and more professionals and soldiers were subsequently dispatched to the front lines. Qiu and Captain Zhang were also dispatched here, and Zhang saw the monsters waiting for them as soon as they got there. Now, a great number of titans were approaching them. Qiu was already aware of the perpetrator, and it's the treacherous wisdom monster god. These titans began to roar, showcasing their power to the human race. This one even turned a small monster into a rock by catching it. I was reminded of the Beast Titan by this scene in the anime Attack on Titan. It launched the monster in the direction of the army camp. The troops knew what was approaching. However, they took too long to respond to this attack. The wall was destroyed when the attack struck it. They were dispatched with a few more of these. The creatures did not end there. They even intended to hurl a single titan in the direction of the base, and they carried it out. One took off like a bird. The wall was also destroyed by the titan when it landed on it. This one was staring at a soldier right now. This person stopped dead in his tracks. At that point, the titan began to wreak havoc throughout the base. These provided an opening for the other smaller monsters to enter the base, and chaos was produced as a result. Captain Zhang tried her hardest to repel these creatures. She also inquired as to Qiu's plans for reversing the situation. and in circumstances like these, our NC never fails. He assured Captain Jiang that he could finalize his plan in just 30 minutes. This woman knew that 30 minutes was not enough time, but they were at a loss for what to do. She'll try her hardest to give Q more time to get ready for his desired action. Captain Jiang began to demonstrate her lightning-fast reflexes. Her lightning-fast reflexes allowed her to dispatch numerous monsters in one swipe. She reached up to the edge of the walls with her attack, and it was there that she noticed numerous monsters attempting to slither up the wall. Since her mother's passing, Jiang had detested her father since her life had been a shadow of his legacy, but she also inherited his lightning skill, and for the time being, she won't dispute the existence of this formidable lightning inside her. Captain Jiang had been hiding her abilities behind a mask, but she took it off now. This woman is still asking her father why, in the midst of a monster sea, he failed to save her. And she's going to fight these monsters until the end of her. She asked her father directly when she went to see him. Captain Jiang then leaped over the wall and toward the sea of monsters below. She stated unequivocally that this was not a suicide. This was her attempt at learning to fly gone wrong. A bolt of lightning struck the earth. Captain Jiang persisted in her assault on the Titan, vanquishing numerous enemies in the process. This woman cut through the monster's hand with her weapon, but her assault was ineffective. And with that, the monster swatted her back to her spot. Q entered the scene to save her before she fell to the ground. Even though RMC managed to catch her, the damage was still severe. Q then complimented Captain Jiang on her diligence. She had done enough, he told her. And Q turned his focus to these titans at this precise moment. RMC informed Jiang that she is not yet capable of taking on a level 8 monster. Bloodraven was summoned once more by Q, who informed her that he did not intend to die here. Q's transformation began as soon as he recovered his sword. Q didn't give a damn if his true form was discovered at this moment. The biggest monster will now put an end to this pointless conflict. It took me an additional 30 minutes to transform back into this form. Additionally, Captain Jiang caught sight of him as he was leaving. It takes her by surprise that this has happened. However, the Titan then launched an assault of his own. In midair, Q met its attack. He also performed numerous slashes. This was sufficient to sever this monster's hands. Q also slashed in a horizontal direction toward the Titan, and a crimson aura cut straight through it. Half of the Titan was severed. A torrent of blood spurted from the Titan's body, and Q utilized this, causing Bloodraven to absorb it all. Song Ming and the chief were also observing Q's fight. He was the same monster that had aided them in the city, so they knew who he was. Song Ming was now eager to apprehend Q in order to carry out additional research and enhance his modified soldiers once more. They were informed of the nuclear weapons aimed towards the monsters by someone who got in touch with them at the same moment. This time, about 35 warheads were used. Then, directly above the professionals and monsters, these nuclear weapons materialized. Some of them had already given up on hope. Song Ming then expressed gratitude to these men for their sacrifices on behalf of humanity. However, there was a visible crack in space as these warheads descended toward the monsters. Suddenly, an eye peered out. Song Ming became frightened upon realizing that this eye belonged to a demon god. Because he believed that this was impossible, he is now in a panic. Humans discovered that the universe operated under certain laws, and one of these guidelines stated that this invisible net was impeding the monsters. The only creatures that could pass through this net were those little, frail ones. Furthermore, the demon gods could not fit through the net because of their enormous size, which was comparable to that of a great white shark. Humanity began to divide its power once they discovered this net. The Peace Factions were a group of experts tasked with eliminating the monsters on Earth. Mask's job was to clear the monsters and keep them from reaching Earth in the interim, and the War Faction was the name of their group. As a result, there were now more issues between the two groups. The other person was busy discrediting Mask in the eyes of the public, while Mask was busy fighting the demon gods. Returning to the present, the warheads continued to aim for the monsters. However, this eye noticed these nuclear weapons. Then, all of these warheads were absorbed by these dark portals that it created. Song Ming was inconsolable. He had no idea that a demon god would show up and foil his schemes. The chief was motionless as well. Song Ming then turned around right away and told the chief he would return to Star City to report the situation. However, the chief was aware that this man was simply fleeing. The chief then fled with Song Ming, realizing they couldn't defeat a demon god. In the meantime, everyone who remained a professional on the battlefield was curious about this eye. The nearby monsters also began to bolster up. Then, RMC carried out his mission. Even so, he overcame a few of the titans. But Q was also knocked out by their enhanced strength. This attack was too strong as well. Back in the corner was RMC. Then, Q's monster form was visible to this eye. Additionally, half of his monster mask was destroyed, exposing RMC's face. The moment the demon gods realized this, something altered. The eye continued to gaze at Q. Captain Giant observed it as well. However, she felt that this was nonsensical. A demon god has no regard for frail people. Mask was the only human who posed a threat to the demon gods. When it saw Q's face, the demon god's eye became alarmed, and with that, it instantly recoiled. The titans began to cease their motion as well, eventually disintegrating into dust. The little monsters began to flee the battlefield as well. This prompted the soldiers and other professionals to begin celebrating. Hugh, in the meantime, recalled the demon god who was afraid to confront him. The face of treacherous wisdom is still hidden from Q, not once, but at the precise instant when Q gave up his mask identity. Once more gathering strength, this demon god launched an assault. A demon god being scared even in this kind of a state was not what Q had anticipated. That demon god was already at level 13, and with a little situation analysis, it could take down Q with ease. With that, the task assigned to RMC was finished. As for his reward, well, he'll be one step closer to becoming a demon god. Q began to experience his first metamorphosis. The monster's entire life force was now moving in his direction. This was a powerful weapon capable of destroying everything. Afterward, Q was cut off. Song Ming and his group was it. Captain Zhang moved to Q's side right away and attempted to defend him. She assured them that Q was not a monster but a human. Song Ming, however, would not put up with any of this. He assured them that despite his monstrous appearance, Q will always be a monster. He also held Q accountable for the catastrophes that occurred in the region when he was a prisoner. The chief allegedly supported these claims. Jiang responded in kind. She persisted in her belief that Q was their ally. He even vanquished the monsters in order to protect humanity. But she was told to keep quiet by this chief. These guys had absolutely no power. He even put Captain Jiang under false pretenses, telling her that it's possible she was with him when they plotted all of this. Then the chief gave his men the order to detain Captain Zhang and Q. Then the soldiers immediately surrounded them. They attempted to attack Q as well, but RMC easily repelled them. The chief moved as well. He was a level 9 professional, this guy. However, Q used his sword to deflect his blow. The chief discovered the full extent of Q's power. He just finished taking on all those titans and is still strong enough to fend off an attack from a level 9 expert. Song Ming wrapped his arms around Q at the same moment. RMC touched Song Ming with his hand, and he proceeded to twist and break them off. Q defeated Song Ming by using the Blood Raven as well. In front of Q, he remained weak and defenseless. RMC gave him a cold, emotionless stare. As soon as Q focused on him, the chief felt unsafe. This guy took off running. But these crimson-colored crows were pursuing him. Q also materialized in front of him out of nowhere. The chief, terrified, began to scream. The man referred to him as a monster. Q again wielded his Blood Raven, slicing through the center. Captain Zhang saw everything that occurred. Then someone showed up. Commander Liang was honoring Q when he appeared. He referred to RMC as his army chief as well. He informed Q that although his eyes were blind, he was aware of his chief's identity from the beginning. He disclosed that, in fact, Q was the same person who had repeatedly saved humanity. He had a mask on. The followers of Mask have been anticipating his return. While they were accumulating as much power as they could, they maintained a low profile. Commander Ling heard nothing from RMC. However, it seemed as though his chief had given him a covert message. Q also began to release his ominous aura. Then he lifted off the battlefield and flew into the sky. He's off to somewhere bigger now. The federal government hosted a conference on this subject a few days after the fight against the Sea of Monsters. They declared that thousands of monsters with levels 5 to 9 could be vanquished by government professionals and soldiers. Nevertheless, they also exposed a few faces they believed to be traitors. They infected the public's minds to believe that these men were involved in a conspiracy with the monsters. They also emphasized Q's predicament. They told everyone that this man became a monster himself because he so f***ed the path of the monster. Many people were very concerned about this. This man then silenced their questions and murmurs, it was Xiao. He explained to the populace that this kind of circumstance was reasonable and anticipated since some people would be drawn to the monster's potential for power. However, he gave everyone hope that humanity will ultimately triumph. They'll fight the traitors gradually while still putting them through a fair trial. These took everything that Xiao said at face value. They were simply too credulous. Then, from a distance, one of the reporters noticed someone standing. It was captured by their camera. The man who was labeled as a monster was the same one. Then the civilians began to flee. Professionals on duty for this event moved in Q's direction. However, RMC simply sidestepped their blows and let them off lightly. This time, he didn't kill any of them. These guys really can't beat Q, even with their best efforts. Q kept moving in the direction of the stage after vanquishing the pros. People grew apart from him as well. They even made a walkway for him to cross. Hio was the person on the other end of the line. The man saw the silhouette of a man he knew instantly. It was the silhouette of his best friend, who fought beside him. It was also the same man that he had previously impeached. Hio now pondered whether Q had identified him in the same manner that Hio had. This guy had been hankering after Q's acceptance and attention for a long time. He felt as though he had lost his best friend ever since Qiu turned into mask. He was always behind the mask, encouraging it on. Hyo then realized that things were different this time. Now he could demonstrate his worth. Hyo was confident he could defeat Qiu at this moment. The same serum that the transformed soldiers used is also in him. He might also be able to harness Q's power with this. However, RNC just kept moving toward the stage. Now Hyo felt every bit of pressure there was. All he had to do to win the support of everyone on the planet was take on Qiu in his current state. He was aware that his time was limited, and Hyo froze out and did nothing after a few seconds. Qiu has elapsed. Our MC stepped in front of the microphone right away. Hyo, meantime, collapsed to his knees. Qiu then gave a brief introduction to everyone. He identified himself as the mask. The fact that the mask was not a monster made the civilians not believe him. Captain Zhang attended the event in addition to the civilian attendees. She still finds it hard to accept that Qiu was actually a mask. Qiu went on to say that he had already returned, but not in the role of their hero. The futility of being a hero has already been demonstrated by humanity, and Qiu was all that was required. What people choose to name him really doesn't matter. He also assured them of one thing in particular. The only person who could guide them out of this chasm was a Qiu. He also clarified and made corrections. A Qiu is not human dependent. However, humanity requires him. This was actuality. If not for masks, humanity ought to have gone extinct a long time ago. These guys continued to doubt Qiu. They believed that the mask would never make these claims. Qiu went on with his remarks. He said to everyone present that it appeared they were afraid of having too much power. And as a result of their fear, they banished their only source of hope. It was never wrong to be weak. However, human pride was. And Qiu will now use humanity to accomplish his objective. He'll use up all of their assets. Our MC said something audacious. He made it plain that the world was in his hands going forward. From now on, he will own and govern everything on Earth. Captain Giant continued to hear Qiu's speech. It dawned on her then what her mentor had said. Commander Lening insisted on going with Qiu because he holds the answers to all of her inquiries, for this reason. She began to cry, causing her cheeks to flush. Qiu was also hailed as a hero by the public. He was even treated like a god by them. Our MC was more than prepared to face the demon gods with this. That's how this video ends. If you have sat through to the end, please don't forget to press the subscribe button and leave feedback. See you in the next video.